Where chaos begins. Physiologists found a surprising order in the chaos that develops in the human heart, the prime cause of sudden, unexplained death. The insights that emerged led directly into the natural world. Chaos has become a shorthand name for a fast-growing movement that is reshaping the fabric of the scientific establishment. Chaos has created special techniques of using computers and special kinds of graphic images, pictures that capture a fantastic and delicate structure underlying complexity. Quarks and gluons are the new elements of matter. To some physicists, chaos is a science of process rather than state, of becoming rather than being. Chaos breaks across the lines that separate scientific disciplines. Because it is a science of the global nature of systems, it has brought together thinkers from fields that had been widely separated. They feel that they are turning back a trend in science toward reductionism, the analysis of systems in terms of their constituent parts, quarks, chromosomes, or neurons. They believe that they are looking for the whole. Relativity, quantum mechanics, and chaos. Relativity eliminated the Newtonian illusion of absolute space and time, quantum theory eliminated the Newtonian dream of a controllable measurement process, and chaos eliminates the Laplacian fantasy of deterministic predictability. Chaos applies to the universe we see and touch, to objects at human scale. Hawking recognized that understanding nature's laws on the terms of particle physics left unanswered the question of how to apply those laws to any but the simplest of systems. As the revolution in chaos runs its course, the best physicists find themselves returning without embarrassment to phenomena on a human scale. Tiny differences in input could quickly become overwhelming differences in output, a phenomenon given the name sensitive dependence on initial conditions. In weather, for example, this translates into what is only half-jokingly known as the butterfly effect, the notion that a butterfly stirring the air today in Peking can transform storm systems next month in New York. Butterfly effect. Families of eddies and cyclones, always obeying mathematical rules, yet never repeating themselves. The essence was the way patterns in the atmosphere changed over time, and that was what Lorentz captured on the Royal McBee. He chose 12. They were numerical rules, equations that expressed the relationships between temperature and pressure, between pressure and wind speed. Those who made such models took for granted that, from present to future, the laws of motion provide a bridge of mathematical certainty. Understand the laws and you understand the universe. Only a computer could cash in the Newtonian promise that the world unfolded along a deterministic path. In theory, a computer could let meteorologists do what astronomers had been able to do with pencil and slide rule, reckon the future of their universe from its initial conditions and the physical laws that guide its evolution. The basic idea of Western science is that there's a convergence in the way things work, and arbitrarily small influences don't blow up to have arbitrarily large effects. One day in the winter of 1961, wanting to examine one sequence at greater length, Lorentz took a shortcut. Instead of starting the whole run over, he started midway through. When he returned an hour later, he saw something unexpected, something that planted a seed for a new science. The problem lay in the numbers he had typed. In the computer's memory, 6 decimal places were stored, 0.506127. On the printout, to save space, just 3 appeared, 0.506. Lorentz had entered the shorter, rounded-off numbers, assuming that the difference 1 part in 1,000 was inconsequential. Given a slightly different starting point, the weather should unfold in a slightly different way. Surely the small puffs faded or cancelled each other out before they could change important, large-scale features of the weather. Yet in Lorentz's particular system of equations, small errors proved catastrophic. Any physical system that behaved non-periodically would be unpredictable. Newspapers and magazines were filled with hope for weather science, not just for prediction but for modification and control. Von Neumann imagined that scientists would calculate the equations of fluid motion for the next few days. But von Neumann had overlooked the possibility of chaos, with instability at every point. Computer modeling had indeed succeeded in changing the weather business from an art to a science. But beyond 2 or 3 days, the world's best forecasts were speculative, and beyond 6 or 7, they were worthless. The butterfly effect was the reason. For small pieces of weather and to a global forecaster, small can mean thunderstorms and blizzards. The modern weather models work with a grid of points on the order of 60 miles apart, and even so, some starting data has to be guessed, since ground stations and satellites cannot see everywhere. Neumann's this is weather control. His thought was that small modifications, well within human capability, could cause desired large-scale changes. Lorentz saw it differently. Yes, you could change the weather. You could make it do something different from what it would otherwise have done. But if you did, then you would never know what it would otherwise have done. You know it will change your luck, but you don't know whether for better or worse. But Lorentz saw more than randomness embedded in his weather model. The butterfly effect was no accident, it was necessary. Suppose small perturbations remain small, he reasoned, instead of cascading upward through the system. Then when the weather came arbitrarily close to a state it had passed through before, it would stay arbitrarily close to the patterns that followed. For practical purposes, the cycles would be predictable and eventually uninteresting. A chain of events can have a point of crisis that could magnify small changes. But chaos meant that such points were everywhere. They were pervasive. In systems like the weather, sensitive dependence on initial conditions was an inescapable consequence of the way small scales intertwined with large. Lorentz looked for even simpler ways to produce this complex behavior. He found one in a system of just three equations. They were nonlinear, meaning that they expressed relationships that were not strictly proportional. A particular kind of fluid motion inspired Lorentz's three equations, the rising of hot gas or liquid, known as convection. In the atmosphere, convection stirs air heated by the sun-baked earth, and shimmering convective waves rise ghost-like above hot tar and radiators. There is a tendency to think that when you see them, there are some nonlinear terms in them, but you think there must be a way to get around them. But you just can't. The geodynamo is known to have flipped many times during the Earth's history, at intervals that seem erratic and inexplicable. Faced with such irregularity, theorists typically look for explanations outside the system, proposing such causes as meteorite strikes. Yet perhaps the geodynamo contains its own chaos. The first, famous chaotic system discovered by Lorentz, a water wheel. Both systems are driven steadily by water or by heat and both dissipate energy. The fluid loses heat, the buckets lose water. In both systems, the long-term behavior depends on how hard the driving energy is. Water pours in from the top at a steady rate. If the flow of water in the water wheel is slow, the top bucket never fills up enough to overcome friction, and the wheel never starts turning. Lorentz discovered, over long periods, the spin can reverse itself many times, never settling down to a steady rate and never repeating itself in any predictable pattern. The Lorentz attractor. It revealed the fine structure hidden within a disorderly stream of data. At any instant in time, the three variables fix the location of a point in three-dimensional space. As the system changes, the motion of the point represents the continuously changing variables. Because the system never exactly repeats itself, the trajectory never intersects itself. Instead, it loops around and around forever. Another system by the Lorentz equations is a certain kind of water wheel. Lorentz found three equations, with three variables, completely described the motion of the system. Lorentz's system did, the map displayed a kind of infinite complexity. It always stayed within certain bounds, never running off the page but never repeating itself, either. It traced a strange, distinctive shape, a kind of double spiral in three dimensions, like a butterfly with its two wings. The shape signaled pure disorder, since no point or pattern of points ever recurred. Yet it also signaled a new kind of order. Years later, no single object would inspire more illustrations, even motion pictures, than the mysterious curve depicted at the end, the double spiral that became known as the Lorentz attractor. Few laymen realized how tightly compartmentalized the scientific community had become, a battleship with bulkhead sealed against leaks. Revolution. Kuhn's pushed a sharp needle into the traditional view that science progresses by the accretion of knowledge, each discovery adding to the last, and that new theories emerge when new experimental facts require them. Normal science consists largely of mopping up operations. Experimentalists carry out modified versions of experiments that have been carried out many times before. Theorists add a brick here, reshape a cornice there, in a wall of theory. Under normal conditions, the research scientist is not an innovator but a solver of puzzles, and the puzzles upon which he concentrates are just those which he believes can be both stated and solved within the existing scientific tradition. Quoting Tolstoy, "I know that most men, including those at ease with problems of the greatest complexity, can seldom accept even the simplest and most obvious truth if it be such as would oblige them to admit the falsity of conclusions which they have delighted in explaining to colleagues, which they have proudly taught to others, and which they have woven, thread by thread, into the fabric of their lives." Chaos has become not just theory but also method, not just a canon of beliefs but also a way of doing science. Chaos has created its own technique of using computers, a technique that does not require the vast speed of craze and cybers but instead favors modest terminals that allow flexible interaction. Revolutions do not come piecemeal. One account of nature replaces another. Old problems are seen in a new light and other problems are recognized for the first time. To explain it required a revolutionary way of understanding objects in motion. Any experimentalist looks for quantities that remain the same, or quantities that are zero. But that means disregarding bits of messiness that interfere with a neat picture. Almost no one in the classical era suspected the chaos that could lurk in dynamical systems if nonlinearity was given its due. Studying chaotic dynamics discovered that the disorderly behavior of simple systems acted as a creative process. It generated complexity, richly organized patterns, sometimes stable and sometimes unstable, sometimes finite and sometimes infinite, but always with the fascination of living things. The tradition of looking at systems locally isolating the mechanisms and then adding them together was beginning to break down. Smale was looking at nonlinear oscillators, chaotic oscillators, and seeing things that physicists had learned not to see. In the most rigorous mathematical terms, he proposed that practically all dynamical systems tended to settle, most of the time, into behavior that was not too strange. As he soon learned, things were not so simple. Smale was a mathematician who did not just solve problems but also built programs of problems for others to solve. Smale's Fields Medal honored a famous piece of work in topology. Topology studies the properties that remain unchanged when shapes are deformed by twisting or stretching or squeezing. Whether a shape is square or round, large or small, is irrelevant in topology. Topology and dynamical systems, went back to Henri Poincaré, had been the last great mathematician to bring a geometric imagination to bear on the laws of motion in the physical world. He was the first to understand the possibility of chaos. Linking topology and dynamical systems is the possibility of using a shape to help visualize the whole range of behaviors of a system. If you can visualize the shape, you can understand the system. A system can behave erratically, but the erratic behavior cannot be stable. Stability in the sense of Smale, stable behavior in a system was behavior that would not disappear just because some number was changed a tiny bit. But you cannot stand a pencil on its point because the solution is unstable. The slightest perturbation draws the system away from that solution. A letter from a colleague informed him that many systems were not so well behaved as he had imagined, and it described a counterexample, a system with chaos and stability, together. Chaos and instability, concepts only beginning to acquire formal definitions, were not the same at all. A chaotic system could be stable if its particular brand of irregularity persisted in the face of small disturbances. Although years would pass before Smale heard about Lorentz. A pendulum in disguise, an oscillating electronic circuit. It was nonlinear and it was periodically forced. It was just a vacuum tube. A modern physics student would explore the behavior of such an oscillator by looking at the line traced on the screen of an oscilloscope. Van der Pol did not have an oscilloscope, so he had to monitor his circuit by listening to changing tones in a telephone handset. He was pleased to discover regularities in the behavior as he changed the current that fed it. Yet once in a while Van der Pol noted something strange. The behavior sounded irregular, in a way that he could not explain. He was one of many scientists who got a glimpse of chaos but had no language to understand it. For a pendulum swinging regularly back and forth, the trajectory through phase space would be a loop, around and around as the system lived through the same sequence of positions over and over again. Smale, instead of looking at any one trajectory, concentrated on the behavior of the entire space as the system changed as more driving energy was added. To represent the full complexity of the van der Pol oscillator, he realized that the phase space would have to suffer a complex new kind of combination of transformations. He quickly turned his idea about visualizing global behavior into a new kind of model. His innovation and enduring image of chaos in the years that followed was a structure that became known as the horseshoe. To make a simple version of Smale's horseshoe, you take a rectangle and squeeze it top and bottom into a horizontal bar. Take one end of the bar and fold it and stretch it around the other, making a C shape, like a horseshoe. Then imagine the horseshoe embedded in a new rectangle and repeat the same transformation, shrinking and folding and stretching. Smale put his horseshoe through an assortment of topological paces, and, the mathematics aside, the horseshoe provided a neat visual analog of the sensitive dependence on initial conditions that Lorentz would discover in the atmosphere a few years later. Pick two nearby points in the original space, and you cannot guess where they will end up. They will be driven arbitrarily far apart by all the folding and stretching. Afterward, two points that happen to lie nearby will have begun arbitrarily far apart. It served as a starting point. The great red spot of Jupiter, a vast, swirling oval, like a giant storm that never moves and never runs down. In the early 1980s, Philip Marcus looked for ways to model the red spot. Since Newton's laws apply everywhere, Marcus programmed a computer with a system of fluid equations. Marcus used far greater computer power to assemble striking color images. First, he made contour plots. He could barely see what was going on. Then he made slides, and then he assembled the images into an animated movie. You see this large-scale spot, happy as a clam amid the small-scale chaotic flow, and the chaotic flow is soaking up energy like a sponge, he said. You see these little tiny filamentary structures in a background sea of chaos. The spot is a self-organizing system, created and regulated by the same nonlinear twists that create the unpredictable turmoil around it. It is stable chaos. And Marcus would see what he realized years later had been the signs of chaos. Marcus eventually learned Lorentz's lesson, that a deterministic system can produce much more than just periodic behavior. He knew to look for wild disorder, and he knew that islands of structure could appear within the disorder. So, he brought to the problem of the great red spot an understanding that a complex system can give rise to turbulence and coherence at the same time. He could work within an emerging discipline that was creating its own tradition of using the computer as an experimental tool. And he was willing to think of himself as a new kind of scientist, not primarily an astronomer, not a fluid dynamicist, not an applied mathematician, but a specialist in chaos. Life's ups and downs. The result of a mathematical development should be continuously checked against one's own intuition about what constitutes reasonable biological behavior. Ecology, that stripped away the noise and color of real life and treated populations as dynamical systems. Ecologists used the elementary tools of mathematical physics to describe life's ebbs and flows. But they always knew that the models were thin approximations of the seething real world. He would have to gather data and try to find equations that produce similar output. Changes year to year are often more important than changes on a continuum. A population reaches equilibrium after rising, overshooting, and falling back. Erratic behavior had nothing to do with the sort of mathematical models he was describing. No good ecologist ever forgot that his equations were vastly oversimplified versions of the real phenomena. The whole point of oversimplifying was to model regularity. Why go to all that trouble just to see chaos? James York had come across Lorentz's 1963 paper Deterministic Nonperiodic Flow. Lorentz's paper was a piece of magic that York had been looking for without even knowing it. It was a mathematical shock, a chaotic system that violated Smale's original optimistic classification scheme. It was a vivid physical model, a picture of a fluid in motion. Mathematicians proved theorems by ratiocination, physicists' proofs used heavier equipment. York gave a copy to Smale. Smale was amazed to see that this meteorologist 10 years earlier had discovered a kind of chaos that Smale himself had once considered mathematically impossible. He made many photocopies of deterministic nonperiodic flow, and thus arose the legend that York had discovered Lorentz. Most differential equations cannot be solved at all. If you could write down the solution to a differential equation, York said, then necessarily it's not chaotic, because to write it down, you must find regular invariants, things that are conserved, like angular momentum. You find enough of these things, and that lets you write down a solution. But this is exactly the way to eliminate the possibility of chaos. Textbooks showed students only the rare nonlinear systems that would give way to such techniques. Nonlinear systems with real chaos were rarely taught and rarely learned. In the past, people have seen chaotic behavior in innumerable circumstances, York said. They're running a physical experiment, and the experiment behaves in an erratic manner. They try to fix it or they give up. They explain the erratic behavior by saying there's noise, or just that the experiment is bad. York's paper was period 3 implies chaos. The resulting cyclical behavior was stable, different starting values for the population would converge on the same 4-year cycle. A population that had been stable would alternate between different levels every other year. A population that had been alternating on a 2-year cycle would now vary on the 3rd and 4th years, thus switching to period 4. If you were following an animal population governed by the simplest of nonlinear equations, you would think the changes from year to year were absolutely random, as though blown about by environmental noise. Yet in the middle of this complexity, stable cycles suddenly return. Even though the parameter is rising, meaning that the nonlinearity is driving the system harder and harder, a window will suddenly appear with a regular period, an odd period, like 3 or 7. The pattern of changing population repeats itself on a 3-year or 7-year cycle. Then the period doubling bifurcations begin all over at a faster rate, rapidly passing through cycles of 3, 6, 12, or 7, 14, 28, and then breaking off once again to renewed chaos. James York analyzed this behavior with mathematical rigor in his period 3 implies chaos paper. He proved that in any one-dimensional system, if a regular cycle of period 3 ever appears, then the same system will also display regular cycles of every other length, as well as completely chaotic cycles. This was the discovery that came as an electric shock. A few years later, attending an international conference in East Berlin, the Russian was claiming to have proved the same result. Sarkovsky had indeed been there first, in a paper titled Coexistence of Cycles of a Continuous Map of a Line into Itself. But York had offered more than a mathematical result. He had sent a message to physicists: chaos is ubiquitous, it is stable, it is structured. He also gave reason to believe that complicated systems, traditionally modeled by hard continuous differential equations, could be understood in terms of easy discrete maps. Biologists had overlooked bifurcations on the way to chaos because they lacked mathematical sophistication and because they lacked the motivation to explore disorderly behavior. Mathematicians had seen bifurcations but had moved on. May, a man with one foot in each world, understood that he was entering a domain that was astonishing and profound. To see deeper into the simplest of systems, scientists needed greater computing power. Fed the logistic nonlinear equation through his control data 6,600 hundreds of millions of times. He took pictures from the computer's display screen at each of 1,000 different values of the parameter, 1,000 different tunings. He knew they were just metaphors, so he began to wonder how widely the metaphors could apply. The other was that the revelations of chaos fed directly into a vehement controversy in his chosen field. Chaos brought an astonishing message. Simple deterministic models could produce what looked like random behavior. The behavior actually had an exquisite fine structure, yet any piece of it seemed indistinguishable from noise. Within a few years, the study of chaos gave a strong impetus to theoretical biology, bringing biologists and physicists into scholarly partnerships. Molecular biologists began to see proteins as systems in motion. Physiologists looked at organs not as static structures but as complexes of oscillations, some regular and some irregular. But May realized that the astonishing structures he had barely begun to explore had no intrinsic connection to biology. Chaos should be taught, he argued. It was time to recognize that the standard education of a scientist gave the wrong impression. May argued that it inevitably misled scientists about their overwhelmingly nonlinear world. The mathematical intuition so developed ill-equips the student to confront the bizarre behavior exhibited by the simplest of discrete nonlinear systems, not only in research, but also in the everyday world of politics and economics. We would all be better off if more people realized that simple nonlinear systems do not necessarily possess simple dynamical properties. A geometry of nature. Economists generally assumed that the price of a commodity like cotton danced to two different beats, one orderly and one random. Over the long term, prices would be driven steadily by real forces in the economy. Over the short term, prices would bounce around more or less randomly. Unfortunately, Houthaker's data failed to match his expectations. There were too many large jumps. Most price changes were small, of course, but the ratio of small changes to large was not as high as he had expected. Gaussian distribution of things, or, simply, the normal distribution. It makes a statement about the nature of randomness. The point is that when things vary, they try to stay near an average point and they manage to scatter around the average in a reasonably smooth way. Mandelbrot confronted problems by depending on his intuition about patterns and shapes. He mistrusted analysis, but he trusted his mental pictures. He carried Houthaker's cotton data in a box of computer cards. Then he sent to the Department of Agriculture in Washington for more, dating back to 1900. Economists were crossing the threshold into the computer era, slowly realizing that they would have the power to collect and organize and manipulate information on a scale that had been unimaginable before. From Mandelbrot's point of view, cotton prices made an ideal data source. When Mandelbrot sifted the cotton price data through IBM's computers, the numbers that produced aberrations from the point of view of normal distribution produced symmetry from the point of view of scaling. Each particular price change was random and unpredictable. But the sequence of changes was independent of scale, curves for daily price changes and monthly price changes matched perfectly. The degree of variation had remained constant over a tumultuous 60-year period that saw two world wars and a depression. Since his early days at IBM, Mandelbrot has failed to exist in a long list of different fields. Hiding his grandest ideas in efforts to get his papers published, surviving mainly on the confidence of his employers in Yorktown Heights.UT, his techniques and his language became an inseparable part of their new science. He had realized that, given an analytic problem, he could almost always think of it in terms of some shape in his mind. Given a shape, he could find ways of transforming it, altering its symmetries, making it more harmonious. Often his transformations led directly to a solution of the analogous problem. Rigor is what allows mathematicians to pick up a line of thought that extends over centuries and continue it, with a firm guarantee. For a mathematician, the choice was clear: he would abandon any obvious connection with nature for a while. Mandelbrot, unbearable. He fled Norma because of Bourbaki, and a decade later he fled France for the same reason, taking up residence in the United States. Within a few decades, the relentless abstraction of Bourbaki would begin to die of a shock brought on by the computer, with its power to feed a new mathematics of the eye. But that was too late for Mandelbrot, unable to live by Bourbaki's formalisms and unwilling to abandon his geometrical intuition. Science would be ruined if it were to put competition above everything else. In a 30-year journey from obscurity to eminence, he never saw his work embraced by the many disciplines toward which he directed it. Mandelbrot was not one of them. Mandelbrot provided a way of describing the distribution of errors that predicted exactly the observed patterns. But it made it impossible to calculate an average rate of errors approached infinite sparseness. His description worked by making deeper and deeper separations between periods of clean transmission and periods of errors. Mandelbrot argued that you could never find a time during which errors were scattered continuously. Within any burst of errors, no matter how short, there would always be periods of completely error-free transmission. Furthermore, he discovered a consistent geometric relationship between the bursts of errors and the spaces of clean transmission. On scales of an hour or a second, the proportion of error-free periods to error-ridden periods remained constant. Mandelbrot was duplicating an abstract construction known as the Cantor set to make a Cantor set. You start with the interval of numbers from 0 to 1, represented by a line segment. Then you remove the middle third. That leaves two segments, and you remove the middle third of each, from 1/9 to 2/9 and from 7/9 to 8/9. That leaves four segments, and you remove the middle third of each and so on to infinity. What remains? A strange dust of points, arranged in clusters, infinitely many yet infinitely sparse. Mandelbrot was thinking of transmission errors as a Cantor set arranged in time. It meant that, instead of trying to increase signal strength to drown out more and more noise, engineers should settle for a modest signal, accept the inevitability of errors and use a strategy of redundancy to catch and correct them. Mandelbrot also changed the way IBM's engineers thought about the cause of noise. Bursts of errors, but Mandelbrot's scaling pattern suggested that the noise would never be explained on the basis of specific local events. The Nile suffers unusually great variation. Mandelbrot classified the variation in terms of two kinds of effects. The NOAA effect means discontinuity. When a quantity changes, it can change almost arbitrarily fast. Prices can change in instantaneous jumps, as swiftly as a piece of news can flash across a teletype wire, and 1,000 brokers can change their minds. A stock market strategy was doomed to fail, Mandelbrot argued, if it assumed that a stock would have to sell for $50 at some point on its way down from $60 to $10. The Joseph effect means persistence. There came 7 years of great plenty throughout the land of Egypt. And there shall arise after them 7 years of famine. Despite an underlying randomness, the longer a place has suffered drought, the likelier it is to suffer more. The NOAA and Joseph effects push in different directions, but they add up to this. Trends in nature are real, but they can vanish as quickly as they come. Clouds are not spheres. The understanding of nature's complexity awaited a suspicion that the complexity was not just random, not just accident. Using imaginary dividers is a way of quantifying the effect of observing an object from different distances, at different scales. An observer trying to estimate the length of England's coastline from a satellite will make a smaller guess than an observer trying to walk its coves and beaches. A fractal shore. A computer-generated coastline, the details are random, but the fractal dimension is constant, so the degree of roughness or irregularity looks the same no matter how much the image is magnified. But Mandelbrot found that as the scale of measurement becomes smaller, the measured length of a coastline rises without limit, bays and peninsulas revealing ever smaller subbays and subpeninsulas at least down to atomic scales, where the process does finally come to an end. Since Euclidean measurements length, depth, thickness failed to capture the essence of irregular shapes, Mandelbrot turned to a different idea, the idea of dimension. We live in a three-dimensional world, meaning that we need three numbers to specify a point, for example, longitude, latitude, and altitude. The three dimensions are imagined as directions at right angles to one another. This is still the legacy of Euclidean geometry, where space has three dimensions, a plane has two, a line has one, and a point has zero. A road map. It uses its two dimensions to carry information of a precisely two-dimensional kind. Mandelbrot appealed, unmathematically, to relativity. The notion that a numerical result should depend on the relation of object to observer is in the spirit of physics in this century and is even an exemplary illustration of it. Mandelbrot moved beyond dimensions 0, 1, 2, 3, to a seeming impossibility, fractional dimensions. The notion is a conceptual high-wire act. Fractional dimension becomes a way of measuring qualities that otherwise have no clear definition. A twisting coastline has a certain characteristic degree of roughness. Mandelbrot specified ways of calculating the fractional dimension of real objects. The claim was that the degree of irregularity remains constant over different scales. Surprisingly often, the claim turns out to be true. Over and over again, the world displays a regular irregularity. Fracture and fraction seemed appropriate. Mandelbrot created the word, noun and adjective, English and French, fractal. A fractal is a way of seeing infinity. Imagine a triangle, each of its sides 1 foot long. Now imagine a certain transformation, a particular, well-defined, easily repeated set of rules. Take the middle one-third of each side and attach a new triangle, identical in shape but one-third the size. The result is a Star of David. Instead of 3 1-foot segments, the outline of this shape is now 12 4-inch segments. Instead of 3 points, there are 6. A curve being any connected line, whether straight or round. On reflection it is a continuous loop, never intersecting itself, because the new triangles on each side are always small enough to avoid bumping into each other. Each transformation adds a little area to the inside of the curve, but the total area remains finite, not much bigger than the original triangle, in fact. If you drew a circle around the original triangle, the curve would never extend beyond it. This paradoxical result, infinite length in a finite space, disturbed many of the turn-off, the century mathematicians who thought about it. Their work made little impact at the time, but mathematicians imagined other shapes with some of the bizarre qualities of the curve. There were piano curves. There were Sierpinski carpets and Sierpinski gaskets. To make a carpet, start with a square, divide it 3 by 3 into 9 equal squares, and remove the central one. Then repeat the operation on the 8 remaining squares, putting a square hole in the center of each. The gasket is the same but with equilateral triangles instead of squares. Fractional dimension proved to be precisely the right yardstick. In a sense, the degree of irregularity corresponded to the efficiency of the object in taking up space. A simple, Euclidean, one-dimensional line fills no space at all. But the outline of the Cook curve, with infinite length crowding into finite area, does fill space. It is more than a line, yet less than a plane. It is greater than one-dimensional, yet less than a two-dimensional form. For the Cook curve, the infinitely extended multiplication by 4/3 gives a dimension of 1.2618. Constructing with holes. Objects made by the technique of adding or removing infinitely many parts. One such shape is the Sierpinski carpet, constructed by cutting the center 1/9 of a square, then cutting out the centers of the 8 smaller squares that remain, and so on. The three-dimensional analog is the Menger sponge, a solid-looking lattice that has an infinite surface area, yet zero volume. Above all, fractal meant self-similar. Self-similarity is symmetry across scale. It implies recursion, pattern inside of pattern. Shapes like the Cook curve display self-similarity because they look exactly the same even under high magnification. The self-similarity is built into the technique of constructing the curves. The same transformation is repeated at smaller and smaller scales. Self-similarity is an easily recognizable quality in the infinitely deep reflection of a person standing between two mirrors, or in the cartoon notion of a fish eating a smaller fish eating a smaller fish. The best place to study earthquakes is the Lamont-Doherty Geophysical Observatory. The distribution of large and small earthquakes followed a particular mathematical pattern, precisely the same scaling pattern that seemed to govern the distribution of personal incomes in a free market economy. Schizosphere. They control the flow of fluid through the ground, the flow of water, the flow of oil, and the flow of natural gas. They control the behavior of earthquakes. Fractal descriptions found immediate application in a series of problems connected to the properties of surfaces in contact with one another. The fractal geometry of surfaces is that surfaces in contact do not touch everywhere. It is the Humpty Dumpty effect. It is why two pieces of a broken teacup can never be rejoined, even though they appear to fit together at some gross scale. At a smaller scale, irregular bumps are failing to coincide. It's a single model that allows us to cope with the range of changing dimensions of the Earth, he said. It gives you mathematical and geometrical tools to describe and make predictions. Once you get over the hump, and you understand the paradigm, you can start actually measuring things and thinking about things in a new way. You see them differently. You have a new vision. It's not the same as the old vision at all, it's much broader. Clouds are scaling phenomena like earthquakes. Their characteristic irregularity, describable in terms of fractal dimension, changes not at all as they are observed on different scales. It is hard to break the habit of thinking of things in terms of how big they are and how long they last. But the claim of fractal geometry is that, for some elements of nature, looking for a characteristic scale becomes a distraction. Blood vessels, from aorta to capillaries, form another kind of continuum. They branch and divide and branch again until they become so narrow that blood cells are forced to slide through single file. The nature of their branching is fractal. The fractal approach embraces the whole structure in terms of the branching that produces it, branching that behaves consistently from large scales to small. Mandelbrot published his Physiological Speculations. Some theoretical biologists began to find fractal organization controlling structures all through the body. The urinary collecting system proved fractal. The biliary duct in the liver. The network of special fibers in the heart that carry pulses of electric current to the contracting muscles. The frequency spectrum of heartbeat timing, like earthquakes and economic phenomena, followed fractal laws. When E.I. DuPont de Nemours produced a synthetic match for goose down, it was by finally realizing that the phenomenal air-trapping ability of the natural product came from the fractal nodes and branches of Down's key protein, keratin. Mandelbrot glided matter-of-factly from pulmonary and vascular trees to real botanical trees, trees that need to capture sun and resist wind, with fractal branches and fractal leaves? Speculate that fractal scaling was not just common but universal in morphogenesis. I started looking in the trash cans of science for such phenomena, because I suspected that what I was observing was not an exception but perhaps very widespread. Mathematicians resented the way he moved in and out of different disciplines, making his claims and conjectures and leaving the real work of proving them to others. Most readers found his references obscure or even useless. Yet for decades, Mandelbrot believes, he had to play games with his work. He had to couch original ideas in terms that would not give offense. He had to delete his visionary-sounding prefaces to get his articles published. When he wrote the first version of his book, published in French in 1975, he felt he was forced to pretend it contained nothing too startling. That was why he wrote the latest version explicitly as a manifesto and a casebook. He was coping with the politics of science. Mandelbrot found his most enthusiastic acceptance among applied scientists working with oil or rock or metals, worked on fractal problems. At General Electric, fractals became an organizing principle in the study of polymers, and also though this work was conducted secretly in problems of nuclear reactor safety. In Hollywood, fractals found their most whimsical application in the creation of phenomenally realistic landscapes, earthly and extraterrestrial, in special effects for movies. The structures that provided the key to nonlinear dynamics proved to be fractal. They made an irrefutable impact on orthodox mathematics and physics as well, but Mandelbrot himself never gained the full respect of those communities. The notion of self-similarity. The first discoveries were realizations that each change of scale brought new phenomena and new kinds of behavior. Extend science's field of view to tinier particles and briefer time scales, and every extension seems to bring new information. Simple shapes are inhuman. They fail to resonate with the way nature organizes itself or with the way human perception sees the world. So science found a use after all for the obscure and fanciful cousins of the Cantor set and the Cook curve. At first, these shapes could have served as items of evidence in the divorce proceedings between mathematics and the physical sciences at the turn of the century, the end of a marriage that had been the dominating theme of science since Newton. Yet, despite Smale and despite Mandelbrot, it was to be the physicists after all who made a new science of chaos. Mandelbrot provided an indispensable language and a catalogue of surprising pictures of nature. As Mandelbrot himself acknowledged, his program described better than it explained. He could list elements of nature along with their fractal dimension, seacoasts, river networks, tree bark, galaxies, and scientists could use those numbers to make predictions. But physicists wanted to know more. They wanted to know why. There were forms in nature, not visible forms, but shapes embedded in the fabric of motion waiting to be revealed. Strange attractors. Turbulence was a problem with pedigree. Werner Heisenberg, on his deathbed, declaring that he will have two questions for God: why relativity, and why turbulence? Theoretical physics had reached a kind of standoff with the phenomenon of turbulence. In effect, science had drawn a line on the ground and said, beyond this we cannot go. On the near side of the line, where fluids behave in orderly ways, there was plenty to work with. Fortunately, a smooth flowing fluid does not act as though it has a nearly infinite number of independent molecules, each capable of independent motion. Instead, bits of fluid that start nearby tend to remain nearby, like horses in harness. What is turbulence then? It is a mess of disorder at all scales, small eddies within large ones. It is unstable. It is highly dissipative, meaning that turbulence drains energy and creates drag. It is motion turned random. But how does flow change from smooth to turbulent? When flow is smooth, or laminar, small disturbances die out. But past the onset of turbulence, disturbances grow catastrophically. Even supercomputers are close to helpless in the face of irregular fluid motion. Something shakes a fluid, exciting it. The fluid is viscous, sticky, so that energy drains out of it, and if you stopped shaking, the fluid would naturally come to rest. When you shake it, you add energy at low frequencies, or large wavelengths, and the first thing to notice is that the large wavelengths decompose into small ones. The assumption of homogeneity turns out not to be true. The assumption of homogeneity gives way to the assumption of intermittency. The intermittent picture, when idealized somewhat, looks highly fractal, with intermixed regions of roughness and smoothness on scales running down from the large to the small. This picture, too, turns out to fall somewhat short of the reality. What happens when turbulence begins? How does a flow cross the boundary from smooth to turbulent? Before turbulence becomes fully developed, what intermediate stages might exist? The Landau picture is a piling up of competing rhythms. When more energy comes into a system, he conjectured, new frequencies begin one at a time, each incompatible with the last, as if a violin string responds to harder bowing by vibrating with a second, dissonant tone, and then a third, and a fourth, until the sound becomes an incomprehensible cacophony. Any liquid or gas is a collection of individual bits, so many that they may as well be infinite. If each piece moved independently, then the fluid would have infinitely many possibilities, infinitely many degrees of freedom, but each particle does not move independently. Its motion depends very much on the motion of its neighbors, and in a smooth flow, the degrees of freedom can be few. Potentially complex movements remain coupled together. Nearby bits remain nearby or drift apart in a smooth, linear way that produces neat lines in wind tunnel pictures. Theorists conduct experiments. Theorists are thinkers, experimenters are craftsmen. Like so much of chaos itself, phase transitions involve a kind of macroscopic behavior that seems hard to predict by looking at the microscopic details. The march of phase transition research had proceeded along stepping stones of analogy. A non-magnet-magnet phase transition proved to be like a liquid-vapor phase transition. The fluid-superfluid phase transition proved to be like the conductor-superconductor phase transition. What other changes in the world would prove to be phase transitions? Fluid bifurcations entailed no change in the substance itself. Instead, they added a new element, motion. A still liquid becomes a flowing liquid. Why should the mathematics of such a change correspond to the mathematics of a condensing vapor? Flow between rotating cylinders. The patterned flow of water between two cylinders gave Harry Swinney and Jerry Golub a way to look at the onset of turbulence. As the rate of spin is increased, the structure grows more complex. First, the water forms a characteristic pattern of flow resembling stacked donuts. Then the donuts begin to ripple. The physicists used a laser to measure the water's changing velocity as each new instability appeared. Swinney and Golub intended to confirm Landau's idea for the onset of turbulence. Swinney studied the liquid vapor critical point in carbon dioxide. He did so with Landau's conviction that his findings would carry over to the liquid vapor critical point in xenon, and indeed they did. Why shouldn't turbulence prove to be a steady accumulation of conflicting rhythms in a moving fluid? There was the transition, very well defined, Swinney said. So that was great. Then we went on, to look for the next one. There the expected Landau sequence broke down. Experiment failed to confirm theory. At the next transition the flow jumped all the way to a confused state with no distinguishable cycles at all. No new frequencies, no gradual buildup of complexity. What we found was, it became chaotic. A few months later a Belgian appeared at the door to their laboratory. The equations of fluid flow are nonlinear partial differential equations, unsolvable except in special cases. Yet Rouelle worked out an abstract alternative to Landau's picture. Rouelle and Taken's argument went beyond mathematics, they meant to offer a substitute for the traditional view of the onset of turbulence. Instead of a piling up of frequencies, leading to an infinitude of independent overlapping motions, they proposed that just three independent motions would produce the full complexity of turbulence. Most seductive of all was an image that the authors called a strange attractor. The strange attractor lives in phase space, one of the most powerful inventions of modern science. Phase space gives a way of turning numbers into pictures, abstracting every bit of essential information from a system of moving parts, mechanical or fluid, and making a flexible roadmap to all its possibilities. In phase space, the complete state of knowledge about a dynamical system at a single instant in time collapses to a point. That point is the dynamical system at that instant. At the next instant, though, the system will have changed, ever so slightly, and so the point moves. The history of the system time can be charted by the moving point, tracing its orbit through phase space with the passage of time. How can all the information about a complicated system be stored in a point? If the system has only two variables, the answer is simple. It is straight from the Cartesian geometry taught in high school: one variable on the horizontal axis, the other on the vertical. If the system is a swinging, frictionless pendulum, one variable is position and the other velocity, and they change continuously, making a line of points that traces a loop, repeating itself forever, around and around. The same system with a higher energy level swinging faster and farther forms a loop in phase space similar to the first, but larger. One advantage of thinking of states as points in space is that it makes change easier to watch. A system whose variables change continuously up or down becomes a moving point. When a scientist looked at a phase portrait, he could use his imagination to think back to the system itself. This loop corresponds to that periodicity. This twist corresponds to that change. This empty void corresponds to that physical impossibility. Even in two dimensions, phase space portraits, even in desktop computers, could easily demonstrate some of them, turning equations into colorful moving trajectories. Spaces of four, five, or more dimensions tax the visual imagination of even the most agile topologist. Mathematicians had to accept the fact that systems with infinitely many degrees of freedom required a phase space of infinite dimensions. But who could handle such a thing? And it was Landau's image for turbulence, infinite modes, infinite degrees of freedom, infinite dimensions. A physicist had good reason to dislike a model that found so little clarity in nature. Using the nonlinear equations of fluid motion, the world's fastest supercomputers were incapable of accurately tracking a turbulent flow of even a cubic centimeter for more than a few seconds. David Rouelle suspected that the visible patterns in turbulent flow, self-entangled streamlines, spiral vortices, whirls that rise before the eye and vanish again, must reflect patterns explained by laws not yet discovered. In his mind, the dissipation of energy in a turbulent flow must still lead to a kind of contraction of the phase space, a pull toward an attractor. Certainly, the attractor would not be a fixed point, because the flow would never come to rest. Energy was pouring into the system as well as draining out. What other kind of attractor could it be? A periodic attractor, or limit cycle, an orbit that attracted all other nearby orbits. If a pendulum gains energy from a spring while it loses it through friction, that is, if the pendulum is driven as well as damped, a stable orbit may be the closed loop in phase space that represents the regular swinging motion of a grandfather clock. No matter where the pendulum starts, it will settle into that one orbit. Or will it? For some initial conditions, those with the lowest energy, the pendulum will still settle to a stop, so the system actually has two attractors, one a closed loop and the other a fixed point. Each attractor has its basin, just as two nearby rivers have their own watershed regions. In the short term, any point in phase space can stand for a possible behavior of the dynamical system. In the long term, the only possible behaviors are the attractors themselves. turbulence is like white noise, or static. Could such a thing arise from a simple, deterministic system of equations? Ruelle and Takens wondered whether some other kind of attractor could have the right set of properties. What kind of orbit could be drawn in a limited space so that it would never repeat itself and never cross itself, because once a system returns to a state it has been in before, it thereafter must follow the same path. To produce every rhythm, the orbit would have to be an infinitely long line in a finite area. It would have to be fractal. By 1971, Lorentz had attached it to his 1963 paper on deterministic chaos, a picture with just two curves on the right, one inside the other, and five on the left. To plot just these seven loops required 500 successive calculations on the computer. A point moving along this trajectory in phase space, around the loops, illustrated the slow, chaotic rotation of a fluid as modeled by Lorentz's three equations for convection. Because the system had three independent variables, this attractor lay in a three-dimensional phase space. The attractor was stable, low-dimensional, and non-periodic. It could never intersect itself. Yet they stayed inside a finite space, confined by a box. How could that be? How could infinitely many paths lie in a finite space? It is difficult to reconcile the merging of two surfaces, one containing each spiral, with the inability of two trajectories to merge. We see that each surface is really a pair of surfaces, so that, where they appear to merge, there are really four surfaces. Continuing this process for another circuit, we see that there are really eight surfaces, etc., and we finally conclude that there is an infinite complex of surfaces, each extremely close to one or the other of two merging surfaces. The first strange attractor. The folding and squeezing of space was a key to constructing strange attractors, and perhaps a key to the dynamics of the real systems that gave rise to them. Making pictures of strange attractors was not a trivial matter. A Poincaré map, in effect, taking a slice from the tangled heart of the attractor, removing a two-dimensional section just as a pathologist prepares a section of tissue for a microscope slide. The Poincaré map removes a dimension from an attractor and turns a continuous line into a collection of points. A Poincaré map could sample the velocity of a pendulum bob each time it passed through its lowest point. Or the investigator could choose some regular time interval, freezing successive states in the flash of an imaginary strobe light. Began to reveal the fine fractal structure guessed at by Lorentz. The most illuminating strange attractor. Michel Henin, an astronomer. Systems that lose energy to friction are dissipative. Astronomical systems are not, they are conservative, or Hamiltonian. Globular clusters are amazingly dense with stars. The problem of how they stay together and how they evolve over time has perplexed astronomers. Dynamically speaking, a globular cluster is a big many-body problem. The two-body problem is easy. Newton solved it completely. Each body, the Earth and the Moon, for example, travels in a perfect ellipse around the system's joint center of gravity. Add just one more gravitational object, however, and everything changes. The three-body problem is hard, and worse than hard. As Poincaré discovered, it is most often impossible. The orbits can be calculated numerically for a while, and with powerful computers they can be tracked for a long while before uncertainties begin to take over. But the equations cannot be solved analytically, which means that long-term questions about a three-body system cannot be answered. And astronomers realized that globular clusters generally must not be stable. Binary star systems tend to form inside them, stars pairing off in tight little orbits, and when a third star encounters a binary, one of the three tends to get a sharp kick. Every so often, a star will gain enough energy from such an interaction to reach escape velocity and depart the cluster forever, the rest of the cluster will then contract slightly. When Henin took on this problem for his doctoral thesis, he made a rather arbitrary assumption, that as the cluster changed scale, it would remain self-similar. Working out the calculations, he reached an astonishing result. The core of a cluster would collapse, gaining kinetic energy and seeking a state of infinite density. Gravithermal collapse. In 1962, he had access for the first time to computers. He imagined a flat sheet placed upright on one side of the galaxy so that every orbit would sweep through it, as horses on a racetrack sweep across the finish line. Then he would mark the point where the orbit crossed this plane and trace the movement of the point from orbit to orbit. A typical orbit might begin with a point toward the lower left of the page. Then, on the next go-round, a point would appear a few inches to the right. Then another, more to the right and up a little and so on. After 10 or 20 points an egg-shaped curve would take shape. The successive points actually make a circuit around the curve, but since they do not come around to exactly the same place, eventually, after hundreds or thousands of points, the curve is solidly outlined. Such orbits are not completely regular, since they never exactly repeat themselves, but they are certainly predictable, and they are far from chaotic. But he continued computing different orbits, steadily increasing the level of energy in their abstract system. He saw first the egg-shaped curve twisted into something more complicated, crossing itself in figure eights and splitting apart into separate loops. Still, every orbit fell on some loop. Then, at even higher levels, another change occurred, quite abruptly. Some orbits became so unstable that the points would scatter randomly across the paper. In some places, curves could still be drawn, in others, no curve fit the points. The picture became quite dramatic, evidence of complete disorder mixed with the clear remnants of order, forming shapes that suggested islands and chains of islands. They tried two different computers and two different methods of integration, but the results were the same. With greater magnification, they suggested, more islands would appear on smaller and smaller scales, perhaps all the way to infinity. Mathematical proof was needed. By 1976, the key, he believed, was the repeated stretching and folding of phase space in the manner of a pastry chef who rolls the dough, folds it, rolls it out again, folds it, creating a structure that will eventually be a sheaf of thin layers. Henin drew a flat oval on a piece of paper. To stretch it, he picked a short numerical function that would move any point in the oval to a new point in a shape that was stretched upward in the center, an arch. This was a mapping point by point, the entire oval was mapped onto the arch. Then he chose a second mapping, this time a contraction that would shrink the arch inward to make it narrower. And then a third mapping turned the narrow arch on its side, so that it would line up neatly with the original oval. The three mappings could be combined into a single function for purposes of calculation. At first the points appear to jump randomly around the screen. But quickly a shape begins to emerge, an outline curved like a banana. The longer the program runs, the more detail appears. Like Lorentz's attractor, Henin's displays infinite regress. The eerie effect of the strange attractor can be appreciated another way when the shape emerges in time, point by point. New points scatter so randomly across the screen that it seems incredible that any structure is there. Any two consecutive points are arbitrarily far apart, just like any two points initially nearby in a turbulent flow. Given any number of points, it is impossible to guess where the next will appear except, of course, that it will be somewhere on the attractor. The points wander so randomly, the pattern appears so ethereally, that it is hard to remember that the shape is an attractor. It is not just any trajectory of a dynamical system. It is the trajectory toward which all other trajectories converge. That is why the choice of starting conditions does not matter. As long as the starting point lies somewhere near the attractor, the next few points will converge to the attractor with great rapidity. The attractor of Henin. A simple combination of folding and stretching produced an attractor that easy to compute as thousands, the millions of points appear, more and more detail emerges. What appear to be single lines prove, on magnification, to be pairs, then pairs of pairs. Yet whether any two successive points appear nearby or far apart is unpredictable. Strange attractors seemed fractal, implying that their true dimension was fractional, but no one knew how to measure the dimension or how to apply such a measurement in the context of engineering problems. No one knew whether strange attractors would say anything about the deepest problem with nonlinear systems. For now, the excitement went beyond pure science. Scientists who saw these shapes allowed themselves to forget momentarily the rules of scientific discourse. Universality. Mitchell Feigenbaum. Order in chaos. It was science's oldest cliché. The idea of hidden unity and common underlying form in nature had an intrinsic appeal. He wanted to do science that would be new. He began by putting aside any thought of understanding real complexity and instead turned to the simplest nonlinear equations he could find. The mystery of the universe. Kenneth Wilson. Thinking in different ways about what happened in phase transitions. Studying the behavior of matter near the point where it changes from one state to another, from liquid to gas, or from unmagnetized to magnetized. Phase transitions tend to be highly nonlinear in their mathematics. The smooth and predictable behavior of matter in any one phase tends to be little help in understanding the transitions. A pot of water on the stove heats up in a regular way until it reaches the boiling point. But then the change in temperature pauses while something quite interesting happens at the molecular interface between liquid and gas. As Kadanoff viewed the problem in the 1960s, phase transitions pose an intellectual puzzle. Think of a block of metal being magnetized. As it goes into an ordered state, it must make a decision. The magnet can be oriented one way or the other. It is free to choose. But each tiny piece of the metal must make the same choice. How? Somehow, in the process of choosing, the atoms of the metal must communicate information to one another. Kadanoff's insight was that the communication can be most simply described in terms of scaling. In effect, he imagined dividing the metal into boxes. Each box communicates with its immediate neighbors. The way to describe that communication is the same as the way to describe the communication of any atom with its neighbors. Hence the usefulness of scaling. The best way to think of the metal is in terms of a fractal-like model, with boxes of all different sizes. Kadanoff's idea, the boiling of liquids, the magnetizing of metals all follow the same rules. Then Wilson did the work that brought the whole theory together under the rubric of renormalization group theory, providing a powerful way of carrying out real calculations about real systems. Renormalization had entered physics in the 1940s as a part of quantum theory that made it possible to calculate interactions of electrons and photons. A problem was that some items seemed to require treatment as infinite quantities, a messy and unpleasant business. Renormalizing the system got rid of the infinities. In the 1960s, Wilson thought about scaling principles. Certain quantities, such as the mass of a particle, had always been considered fixed, as the mass of any object in everyday experience is fixed. The renormalization shortcut succeeded by acting as though a quantity like mass were not fixed at all. Such quantities seemed to float up or down depending on the scale from which they were viewed. It seemed absurd. Yet it was an exact analog of what Benoit Mandelbrot was realizing about geometrical shapes and the coastline of England. Their length could not be measured independent of scale. There was a kind of relativity in which the position of the observer, near or far, on the beach or in a satellite, affected the measurement. As Mandelbrot, too, had seen, the variation across scales was not arbitrary, it followed rules. Variability in the standard measures of mass or length meant that a different sort of quantity was remaining fixed. In the case of fractals, it was the fractional dimension, a constant that could be calculated and used as a tool for further calculations. Allowing mass to vary depending on scale meant that mathematicians could recognize similarity across scales. Feigenbaum loved Wilson's new renormalization group theory. By acknowledging self-similarity, it gave a way of collapsing the complexity, one layer at a time. He tried it on the problem of turbulence. But what about the onset of turbulence? There was no evidence that the renormalization group had anything to say about this transition. What is red? To a physicist, it is light radiating in waves between 620 to 800 billionths of a meter long. Color is a degree of darkness. Goethe argued, allied to shadow, color comes from boundary conditions and singularities. Newton broke light apart and found the most basic physical explanation for color. Goethe walked through flower gardens and studied paintings, looking for a grand, all-encompassing explanation. Newton made his theory of color fit a mathematical scheme for all of physics. Goethe, fortunately or unfortunately, abhorred mathematics. Feigenbaum persuaded himself that Goethe had been right about color. Goethe's ideas resemble a facile notion that makes a distinction between hard physical reality and the variable subjective perception of it. Goethe's ideas were hard and empirical. It was the perception of color was universal and objective. Redness is not necessarily a particular bandwidth of light, as the Newtonians would have it. It is a territory of a chaotic universe, and the boundaries of that territory are not so easy to describe, yet our minds find redness with regular and verifiable consistency. Does a climate exist? That is, does the Earth's weather have a long-term average? Surely any measurable behavior, no matter how it fluctuates, must have an average. Yet on reflection, it is far from obvious. As Lorentz pointed out, the average weather for the last 12,000 years has been notably different than the average for the previous 12,000. Was there one climate that changed to another for some physical reason? Or is there an even longer-term climate within which those periods were just fluctuations? Or is it possible that a system like the weather may never converge to an average? Suppose you could actually write down the complete set of equations that govern the weather. In other words, suppose you had God's own code. Could you then use the equations to calculate average statistics for temperature or rainfall? If the equations were linear, the answer would be an easy yes. But they are non-linear. Since God has not made the actual equations available, Lorentz instead examined the quadratic difference equation. Lorentz first examined what happened as the equation was iterated, given some parameter. With low parameters, he saw the equation reaching a stable fixed point. There, certainly, the system produced a climate in the most trivial sense possible. The weather never changed. With higher parameters, he saw the possibility of oscillation between two points, and there, too, the system converged to a simple average. But beyond a certain point, Lorentz saw that chaos ensues. Since he was thinking about climate, he asked not only whether continual feedback would produce periodic behavior, but also what the average output would be. And he recognized that the answer was that the average, too, fluctuated unstably. When the parameter value was changed ever so slightly, the average might change dramatically. By analogy, the Earth's climate might never settle reliably into an equilibrium with average long-term behavior. Lorentz was coming to understand ever more deeply the peculiar possibilities of chaotic systems. An observer might see one kind of behavior over a very long time, yet a completely different kind of behavior could be just as natural for the system. Such a system is called intransitive. It can stay in one equilibrium or the other, but not both. Only a kick from outside can force it to change states. Climatologists who use global computer models to simulate the long-term behavior of the Earth's atmosphere and oceans have known for several years that their models allow at least one dramatically different equilibrium. White Earth climate, an Earth whose continents are covered by snow and whose oceans are covered by ice. In general, the climate would be less hospitable to life as we know it. Computer models have such a strong tendency to fall into the white earth equilibrium. But Lorentz described yet another plausible kind of behavior called almost intransitivity. An almost intransitive system displays one sort of average behavior for a very long time, fluctuating within certain bounds. Then, for no reason whatsoever, it shifts into a different sort of behavior, still fluctuating but producing a different average. It takes no great imagination for a climatologist to see that almost intransitivity might well explain why the Earth's climate has drifted in and out of long ice ages at mysterious, irregular intervals. If so, no physical cause need be found for the timing. The ice ages may simply be a byproduct of chaos. HP, 65 handheld calculator 1975. With his calculator he began to use a combination of analytic algebra and numerical exploration to piece together an understanding of the quadratic map, concentrating on the boundary region between order and chaos. En route to chaos in this region was a cascade of period doublings, the splitting of two cycles into four cycles into eight cycles, and so on. These splittings made a splittings fascinating pattern. They were the points at which a slight change in fecundity, for example, might lead a population of gypsy moths to change from a four-year cycle to an eight-year cycle. It took ages, minutes, in fact, to calculate the exact parameter value of each period doubling. Feigenbaum might have observed no pattern. Yet, there was an unexpected regularity hidden in the system. The numbers were converging geometrically, the way a line of identical telephone poles converges toward the horizon in a perspective drawing. If you know how big to make any two telephone poles, you know all the rest. The ratio of the second to the first will also be the ratio of the third to the second, and so on. The period doublings were not just coming faster and faster, but they were coming faster and faster at a constant rate. Feigenbaum knew what he had, because geometric convergence meant that something in this equation was scaling, and he knew that scaling was important. In an apparently unruly system, scaling meant that some quality was being preserved while everything else changed. Some regularity lay beneath the turbulent surface of the equation. But where? It was hard to see what to do next. So he took his HP, 65 again and began to compute the period doublings for XT plus 1 equals R sin P XT. He got a result to 3 decimal places, 4.669. It was the same number. Incredibly, this trigonometric function was not just displaying a consistent, geometric regularity. It was displaying a regularity that was numerically identical to that of a much simpler function. No mathematical or physical theory existed to explain why two equations so different in form and meaning should lead to the same result. He asked a colleague to teach him Fortran. He had calculated his constant to 5 decimal places, 4.66920. That night he read about double precision in the manual, and the next day he got as far as 4.66920160090. He had set out to look for regularity. That was what understanding mathematics meant, but he had also set out knowing that particular kinds of equations, just like particular physical systems, behave in special, characteristic ways. These equations were simple, after all. Feigenbaum understood the quadratic equation, he understood the sine equation, the mathematics was trivial. Yet something in the heart of these very different equations, repeating over and over again, created a single number. The whole tradition of physics is that you isolate the mechanisms and then all the rest flows, he said. That's completely falling apart. Here you know the right equations but they're just not helpful. They're not what's important in the problem. It completely changes what it means to know something. Feigenbaum had found evidence that he needed to work out a new way of calculating complex nonlinear problems. Nature had pulled back a curtain for an instant and offered a glimpse of unexpected order. What else was behind that curtain? He was studying attractors. The steady equilibrium reached by his mappings is a fixed point that attracts all others no matter what the starting population, it will bounce steadily in toward the attractor. Then, with the first period doubling, the attractor splits into, like a dividing cell. At first, these two points are practically together, then, as the parameter rises, they float apart. Then another period doubling, each point of the attractor divides again, at the same moment. Feigenbaum's number let him predict when the period doublings would occur. Now he discovered that he could also predict the precise values of each point on this ever more complicated attractor. 2 points, 4 points, 8 points, he could predict the actual populations reached in the year-to-year oscillations. There was yet another geometric convergence. These numbers, too, obeyed a law of scaling. Numbers and functions were his object of study, instead of mesons and quarks. They had trajectories and orbits. He needed to inquire into their behavior. He needed to create intuition. They needed to create miniature universes and observe their evolution. Then they could change this feature or that and observe the changed paths that would result. That tiny changes in certain features could lead to remarkable changes in overall behavior. Feigenbaum became the recipient of a $20,000 desktop calculator. Then he could change his equations and pictures on the run, tweaking them and tuning them. He worked for 2 months without pause. His functional day was 22 hours. He would try to go to sleep in a kind of buzz, and awaken 2 hours later with his thoughts exactly where he had left them. In the end, a doctor called it off. He prescribed a modest regimen of Valium and an enforced vacation. But by then Feigenbaum had created a universal theory. Universality made the difference between beautiful and useful. Universality meant that different systems would behave identically. He believed that his theory expressed a natural law about systems at the point of transition between orderly and turbulent. Turbulence meant a continuous spectrum of different frequencies, and everyone had wondered where the different frequencies came from. Feigenbaum's universality was not just qualitative, it was quantitative, not just structural, but metrical. It extended not just to patterns, but to precise numbers. Even without publication, Feigenbaum described his work at conferences, and requests for photocopies of his papers came in by the score and then by the hundred. When a discovery is made, when an idea is expressed, it is assumed to become the common property of the scientific world. Science rises like a building, brick by brick. Intellectual chronicles can be, for all practical purposes, linear. But Feigenbaum's role would become a special source of contention. The more a scientist had thought about nonlinearity, the more he felt the force of Feigenbaum's universality. In the summer of 1977, two physicists, Joseph Ford and Giulio Cassati, organized the first conference on a science called chaos. 100 people came, mostly physicists, but also curious scientists from other fields. Later, Feigenbaum lived in a bare space, a bed in one room, a computer in another, and, in the third, three black electronic towers for playing his solidly Germanic record collection. What does this theory tell you the world looks like? In the end, it's so far out of your normal way of picturing things that you run into all sorts of conflicts. Now maybe that's the way the world really is. But you don't really know that there isn't another way of assembling all this information that doesn't demand so radical a departure from the way in which you intuit things. A fundamental presumption in physics is that there are a small number of principles that you can discern by looking at things in their pure state. This is the true analytic notion, and then somehow you put these together in more complicated ways when you want to solve more dirty problems. If you can. In the end, to understand you have to change gears. You have to reassemble how you conceive of the important things that are going on. A general description of what happens in a large variety of systems when things work on themselves again and again. It requires a different way of thinking about the problem. One has to look for different ways. One has to look for scaling structures. How do big details relate to little details? The only things that can ever be universal, in a sense, are scaling things. In a way, art is a theory about the way the world looks to human beings. It's abundantly obvious that one doesn't know the world around us in detail. What artists have accomplished is realizing that there's only a small amount of stuff that's important, and then seeing what it was. Turbulent fluids for those painters is always something with a scale idea in it. I truly do want to know how to describe clouds. But to say there's a piece over here with that much density, and next to it a piece with this much density to accumulate that much detailed information, I think is wrong. It's certainly not how a human being perceives those things, and it's not how an artist perceives them. Somewhere the business of writing down partial differential equations is not to have done the work on the problem. Somehow the wondrous promise of the earth is that there are things beautiful in it, things wondrous and alluring, and by virtue of your trade you want to understand them. The experimenter. Albert Leibchaber, a low-temperature physicist, studying the quantum behavior of superfluid helium at temperatures a breath away from absolute zero. In 1977 he was wasting his time and the university's resources on an experiment that seemed trivial. Build an experiment that would reveal the onset of turbulence. Helium in a small box. The heart of the experiment was even smaller, a cell about the size of a lemon seed, carved in stainless steel with the sharpest possible edges and walls. Into the cell was fed liquid helium chilled to about 4 degrees above absolute zero, warm compared to Leibchaber's old superfluid experiments. The apparatus that held Leibchaber's minuscule fluid cell was a striking bit of purposefulness. Below the stainless steel cell sat a bottom plate of high-purity copper. Above sat a top plate of sapphire crystal. The materials were chosen according to how they conducted heat. There were tiny electric heating coils and Teflon gaskets. The liquid helium flowed down from a reservoir, itself just a half-inch cube. The whole system sat inside a container that maintained an extreme vacuum. And that container, in turn, sat in a bath of liquid nitrogen, to help stabilize the temperature. Ion always worried Leibchaber. Experiments, like real nonlinear systems, existed against a constant background of noise. Noise hampered measurement and corrupted data. Insensitive flows and Leibchaber's would be as sensitive as he could make it. Noise might sharply perturb a nonlinear flow, knocking it from one kind of behavior into another. But nonlinearity can stabilize a system as well as destabilize it. Nonlinear feedback regulates motion, making it more robust. In a linear system, a perturbation has a constant effect. In the presence of nonlinearity, A perturbation can feed on itself until it dies away and the system returns automatically to a stable state. Lipchaber believed that biological systems use their nonlinearity as a defense against noise. The transfer of energy by proteins, the wave motion of the heart's electricity, the nervous system, all these kept their versatility in a noisy world. Lipchaber hoped that whatever structure underlay fluid flow would prove robust enough for his experiment to detect helium in a small box. Its heart was a carefully machined rectangular cell containing liquid helium. Tiny sapphire bolometers measured the fluid's temperature. The tiny cell was embedded in a casing designed to shield it from the noise and vibration and to allow precise control of the heating. His plan was to create convection in the liquid helium by making the bottom plate warmer than the top plate. It was exactly the convection model described by Edward Lorentz, the classic system known as Rayleigh-Bennard convection. Lipchaber knew that no clear image of the onset of turbulence had emerged in a laboratory, and he decided that his speck of a fluid cell would give a picture of the greatest possible clarity. He was an experimenter, yet he had a feeling for the abstract, ill-defined, ghostly thing called flow. Flow was shape plus change, motion plus form. A physicist, conceiving systems of differential equations, would call their mathematical movement a flow. Flow was a Platonic idea, assuming that change in systems reflected some reality independent of the particular instant. If you think of a flow, you can think of a flow in many ways, flow in economics or a flow in history. First it may be laminar, then bifurcating to a more complicated state, perhaps with oscillations. Then it may be chaotic, all set just beyond reach of the standard differential calculus approach to equations of change. But that was not easy to see. Lipchaber's intuition about flow needed the language of poetry. Stevens's poetry, The Flecked River, which kept flowing and never the same way twice, flowing through many places, as if it stood still in one. That, in the shadowless atmosphere, the knowledge of things lay round but unperceived. Lipchaber in the 1970s began looking into the motion of fluids. They did so with something approaching this subversive poetic intent. They suspected a connection between motion and universal form. They accumulated data in the only way possible, writing down numbers or recording them in a digital computer. But then they looked for ways to organize the data in ways that would reveal shapes. They hoped to express shapes in terms of motion. They were convinced that dynamical shapes like flames and organic shapes like leaves borrowed their form from some not yet understood weaving of forces. These experimenters, the ones who pursued chaos most relentlessly, succeeded by refusing to accept any reality that could be frozen motionless. But their conception came close to what Stevens felt as an insolid billowing of the solid. The vigor of glory, a glittering in the veins, as things emerged and moved and were dissolved, either in distance, change, or nothingness, the visible transformations of summer night, an Argentine abstraction approaching form and suddenly denying itself away. Sensitive chaos da sensible chaos was Schwenk's phrase for the relation between force and form. It was a book first about water. He laid out a multitude of natural flowing shapes with an artist's eye. He assembled photographs and made dozens of precise drawings, like the sketches of a cell biologist peering through his first microscope. Flow fills his pages. Great rivers like the Mississippi and the Bassin d'Arcachon in France meander in wide curves to the sea. A river that builds its own banks out of the cold water itself. When the flow itself is past or invisible, the evidence of flow remains. The flow of the ebbing tide inscribes a network of veins on a beach. His archetypal principle was this: that flow wants to realize itself, regardless of the surrounding material. Within currents, he knew, there are secondary currents. Water moving down a meandering river flows, secondarily, around the river's axis, toward one bank, down to the riverbed, across toward the other bank, up toward the surface, like a particle spiraling around a donut. The trail of any water particle forms a string twisting around other strings. This picture of strands twisted together in a spiral is only accurate with respect to the actual movement. One does often speak of strands of water, they are however not really single strands but whole surfaces, interweaving spatially and flowing past each other. He saw rhythms competing in waves, waves overtaking one another, dividing surfaces, and boundary layers. He saw eddies and vortices and vortex trains, understanding them as the rolling of one surface about another. His artistic conviction assumed universality. To Schwenk, vortices meant instability, and instability meant that a flow was fighting an inequality within itself, and the inequality was archetypal. All followed one path, as he saw it. It had nothing to do with any particular medium, or any particular kind of difference. Wentworth Thompson's It may be that all the laws of energy, and all the properties of matter, and all the chemistry of all the colloids are as powerless to explain the body as they are impotent to comprehend the soul. For my part, I think not. Thompson brought to the study of life exactly what Schwenk, fatally, lacked: mathematics. Thompson had pursued the undeniable unity of living organisms. Few had asked whether all the patterns might be reduced to a single system of generating forces, as Gould put it. and few seemed to sense what significance such a proof of unity might possess for the science of organic form. He tried to see life whole, using methods that reduced organisms to their constituent functioning parts. Reductionism triumphed. How else to understand cells but by understanding membranes and nuclei and ultimately proteins, enzymes, chromosomes, and base pairs? He also studied the distinction between final cause and efficient or physical cause. Final cause is cause based on purpose or design, a wheel is round because that shape makes transportation possible. Physical cause is mechanical, the earth is round because gravity pulls a spinning fluid into a spheroid. The distinction is not always so obvious. In science, physical cause dominates. No small part of the pain came from discarding arguments by design, forward-looking teleology. The earth is what it is so that humanity can do what it does. In biology, Darwin firmly established teleology as the central mode of thinking about cause. Natural selection operates not on genes or embryos, but on the final product. So an adaptationist explanation for the shape of an organism or the function of an organ always looks to its cause, not its physical cause but its final cause. Thompson saw this coming. He begged that biology remember physical cause as well, mechanism and teleology together. He devoted himself to explaining the mathematical and physical forces that work on life. Thompson's intuition about the forces that shape life came closer to the perspective of dynamical systems. He thought of life as life, always in motion, always responding to rhythms, the deep-seated rhythms of growth which he believed created universal forms. He considered his proper study not just the material forms of things but their dynamics, the interpretation, in terms of force, of the operations of energy. He was enough of a mathematician to know that cataloging shapes proved nothing. But he was enough of a poet to trust that neither accident nor purpose could explain the striking universality of forms he had assembled in his long years of gazing at nature. Physical laws must explain it, governing force and growth in ways that were just out of understanding's reach. Plato again. Behind the particular, visible shapes of matter must lie ghostly forms serving as invisible templates. Forms in motion. Liquid helium has exceedingly low viscosity, so it will roll at the slightest push. To cause convection in his millimeter-wide cell, he had only to create a temperature difference of a thousandth of a degree between the top and bottom surfaces. In a box 10 times larger in each direction, the size of a grape convection would begin with a heat differential of a millionth of a degree. Such minute temperature variations could not be controlled. They did all they could to eliminate the motion they were trying to study. Fluid motion, from smooth flow to turbulence, is thought of as motion through space. Its complexity appears as a spatial complexity, its disturbances and vortices as a spatial chaos. But Libchaber was looking for rhythms that would expose themselves as change over time. He squeezed space down nearly to a one-dimensional point. Everyone knew that an enclosed flow behaved measurably better than an open flow. In open flow, the boundary surface remains free, and the complexity multiplies. He chose the dimensions of his cell carefully to allow precisely enough room for two rolls. The liquid helium would rise in the center, turn up and over to the left and right, and then descend on the outside edges of the cell. Clean lines and careful proportions would eliminate any extraneous fluctuations. Libchaber froze the space so that he could play with the time. Once the experiment began, the helium rolling inside the cell inside the vacuum container inside the nitrogen bath, Libchaber would need some way to see what was happening. He embedded 2 microscopic temperature probes in the sapphire upper surface of the cell. Their output was recorded continuously by a pen plotter. Thus, he could monitor the temperatures at 2 spots at the top of the fluid. Took 2 years to explore fully. Libchaber found a more intricate pattern of behavior in the onset of turbulence than he had ever imagined. The full period doubling cascade appeared. Libchaber confined and purified the motion of a fluid that rises when heated. The process begins with the first bifurcation, the onset of motion as soon as the bottom plate of high purity copper heats up enough to overcome the tendency of the fluid to remain still. At a few degrees above absolute zero, a mere 1,000th of a degree is enough. The liquid at the bottom warms and expands enough to become lighter than the cool liquid above. To let the warm liquid rise, the cool liquid must sink. Immediately, to let both motions occur, the liquid organizes itself into a pair of rolling cylinders. The rolls reach a constant speed, and the system settles into an equilibrium, a moving equilibrium, with heat energy being converted steadily into motion and dissipating through friction back to heat and passing out through the cool top plate. It also happened to be precisely the flow that Lorentz had modeled with his system of 3 equations. Libchaber analyzed such data by turning it into a spectrum diagram, meant to reveal the main frequencies hidden in the changing temperatures. The first wavelength to appear was about 2 seconds. The next bifurcation brought a subtle change. The roll continued to wobble and the bolometer temperature continued to rise and fall with a dominant rhythm. The maximum temperature split in two, so that there were 2 different maximums and 2 minimums. The pen line, though hard to read, developed a wobble on top of a wobble, a metawobble. On the spectrum diagram, that showed up more clearly. The old frequency was still strongly present, since the temperature still rose every 2 seconds. Now, however, a new frequency appeared at exactly half the old frequency, because the system had developed a component that repeated every 4 seconds. As the bifurcations continued, it was possible to distinguish a strangely consistent pattern. New frequencies appeared at double the old, so that the diagram filled in the quarters and the eighths and the sixteenths, starting to resemble a picket fence with alternating short and tall pickets. How could they know, really, what was happening inside that tiny cell? Even a cell like Libchaber's, so carefully structured, had a virtual infinitude of fluid particles. Each particle represented at least the potential for independent motion. In some circumstances, any particle might be the locus of some new twist or vortex. Libchaber's spectrum diagrams showed vividly the precise pattern of period doubling predicted by theory. The spikes of new frequencies stand out clearly above the experimental noise. Feigenbaum's scaling theory predicted not only when and where the new frequencies would arrive but also how strong they would be their amplitudes. It was Hohenberg, in the end, who brought the theorist and the experimenter together. Theorists adapted Feigenbaum's techniques and found other mathematical roots to chaos, cousins of period doubling, such patterns as intermittency and quasi-periodicity. These, too, proved universal in theory and experiment. Physicists discovered that computers produced the same qualitative pictures as real experiments, and produced them millions of times faster and more reliably. A computer model is just a set of arbitrary rules, chosen by programmers. No computer today can completely simulate even so simple a system as Libchaber's liquid helium cell. He would say that computer simulations help to build intuition or to refine calculations, but they do not give birth to genuine discovery. The patterns he found were indeed abstract. They were mathematical. They said nothing about the properties of liquid helium or copper or about the behavior of atoms near absolute zero. The patterns were there to see the first time he succeeded in raising the temperature enough to isolate the first period doubling, and the next, and the next. According to the new theory, the bifurcations should have produced a geometry with precise scaling, and that was just what Libchaber saw, the universal Feigenbaum constants turning in that instant from a mathematical ideal to a physical reality, measurable and reproducible. He remembered the feeling long afterward, the eerie witnessing of one bifurcation after another and then the realization that he was seeing an infinite cascade, rich with structure. It was, as he said, amusing. Images of chaos. 1979, Barnsley. Where were these cycles of 2, 4, 8, 16 coming from? In the complex plane, the numbers from minus infinity to infinity, all the real numbers, that is, lie on a line stretching from the far west to the far east, with zero at the center. But this line is only the equator of a world that also stretches to infinity in the north and the south. Each number is composed of two parts, a real part, corresponding to east-west longitude, and an imaginary part, corresponding to north-south latitude. By convention, these complex numbers are written this way, 2 plus 3i, the I signifying the imaginary part. The two parts give each number a unique address in this two-dimensional plane. The original line of real numbers, then, is just a special case, the set of numbers whose imaginary part equals zero. In the complex plane, to look only at the real numbers only at points on the equator would be to limit one's vision to occasional intersections of shapes that might reveal other secrets when viewed in two dimensions. These cycles do not appear out of thin air after all, he realized. They fall into the real line off the complex plane, where, if you look, there is a constellation of cycles, of all orders. Hubbard. Newton's method begins with a guess. The guess leads to a better guess, and the process of iteration zooms in on an answer like a dynamical system seeking its steady state. Newton's method is that equations usually have more than one solution, particularly when complex solutions are included. Thinking geometrically, that the method simply seeks out whichever of the two roots is closer to the initial guess. Arthur Cayley had tried in 1879 to move from the manageable second-degree case to the frighteningly intractable third-degree case. But Hubbard treated Newton's method not as a way of solving problems but as a problem in itself. Hubbard considered the simplest example of a degree 3 polynomial, the equation x3 1 equals 0. That is, find the cube root of 1. In real numbers, of course, there is just the trivial solution, 1. But the polynomial also has two complex solutions, 1/2 plus 4/3/2, and 1/2, 4/3/2. Plotted in the complex plane, these three roots mark an equilateral triangle, with one point at 3 o'clock, one at 7 o'clock, and one at 11 o'clock. Given any complex number as a starting point, the question was to see which of the three solutions Newton's method would lead to. It was as if Newton's method were a dynamical system and the three solutions were three attractors. He found, the dynamics of Newton's method did indeed divide the plane into three pi wedges. Generally, the points near a particular solution led quickly into that solution. But systematic computer exploration showed complicated underlying organization. While some starting guesses converged quickly to a root, others bounced around seemingly at random before finally converging to a solution. Sometimes it seemed that a point could fall into a cycle that would repeat itself forever, a periodic cycle without ever reaching one of the three solutions. The picture that began to emerge. Instead of a neat ridge between the blue and red valleys, for example, he saw blotches of green, strung together like jewels. A boundary between two colors never quite forms. On even closer inspection, the line between a green blotch and the blue valley proved to have patches of red. And so on, the boundary finally revealed to Hubbard a peculiar property that no point serves as a boundary between just two colors. Wherever two colors try to come together, the third always inserts itself, with a series of new, self-similar intrusions. Impossibly, every boundary point borders a region of each of the three colors. He realized that the mapping of Newton's method was just one of a whole unexplored family of pictures that reflected the behavior of forces in the real world. The Mandelbrot set is the most complex object in mathematics. But here is a paradox: to send a full description of the set over a transmission line requires just a few dozen characters of code. A terse computer program contains enough information to reproduce the entire set. When Mandelbrot tried to find a way of generalizing about a class of shapes known as Julia sets. Some Julia sets are like circles that have been pinched and deformed in many places to give them a fractal structure. But neither words nor the concepts of Euclidean geometry serve to describe them. 1979 Mandelbrot. The Feigenbaum sequence of bifurcations. As he tried calculating in finer and finer detail, instead of becoming sharper, the pictures became messy. The growing messiness was the sign of something real. Sprouts and tendrils spun languidly away from the main island. Mandelbrot saw a seemingly smooth boundary resolve itself into a chain of spirals like the tails of seahorses. The Mandelbrot set is a collection of points. Every point in the complex plane, that is, every complex number, is either in the set or outside it. One way to define the set is in terms of a test for every point, involving some simple iterated arithmetic. To test a point, take the complex number, square it, add the original number, square the result, add the original number, square the result, and so on, over and over again. If the total runs away to infinity, then the point is not in the Mandelbrot set. If the total remains finite, it could be trapped in some repeating loop, or it could wander chaotically, then the point is in the Mandelbrot set. This business of repeating a process indefinitely and asking whether the result is infinite resembles feedback processes in the everyday world. To model this feedback process with numbers, you might take a starting number, multiply it by itself, multiply the result by itself, and so on. You would discover that large numbers lead quickly to infinity, 10, 100, 10,000. But small numbers lead to 0, 1/2, 1/4, 1/16. To make a geometric picture, you define a collection of all the points that, when fed into this equation, do not run away to infinity. Consider the points on a line from 0 upward. If a point produces a squeal of feedback, color it white. Otherwise, color it black. Soon enough, you will have a shape that consists of a black line from 0 to 1. The Mandelbrot set emerges. In Benoit Mandelbrot's first crude computer printouts, a rough structure appeared, gaining more detail as the quality of the computation improved. Were the bug-like, floating molecules isolated islands? Or were they attached to the main body by filaments too fine to be observed? It was impossible to tell. For a one-dimensional process, no one need actually resort to experimental trial. It is easy enough to establish that numbers greater than 1 lead to infinity and the rest do not. But in the two dimensions of the complex plane, to deduce a shape defined by an iterated process, knowing the equation is generally not enough. The Mandelbrot set allows no shortcuts. Trial and error style brought the explorers of this new terrain closer in spirit to Magellan than to Euclid. Standard geometry takes an equation and asks for the set of numbers that satisfy it. The solutions to an equation like x2 plus y2 equals 1, then, form a shape, in this case a circle. Mandelbrot set, the calculation was simple, because the process itself was so simple, the iteration in the complex plane of the mapping z rightward arrow z2 plus c. Take a number, multiply it by itself, and add the original number. He did understand it. If the boundary were merely fractal in the sense of Mandelbrot's turn of the century monsters, then one picture would look more or less like the last. The principle of self-similarity at different scales would make it possible to predict what the electronic microscope would see at the next level of magnification. Instead, each foray deeper into the Mandelbrot set brought new surprises. Mandelbrot started worrying that he had offered too restrictive a definition of fractal. He certainly wanted the word to apply to this new object. The set did prove to contain, when magnified enough, rough copies of itself, tiny bug-like objects floating off from the main body, but greater magnification showed that none of these molecules exactly matched any other. No part of the set exactly resembles any other part, at any magnification. The discovery of floating molecules raised an immediate problem. He focused more sharply on the specks hovering about the main body. Some disappeared, but others grew into clear near replicas. They seemed independent. But possibly they were connected by lines so thin that they continued to escape the lattice of computed points. The mathematicians proved that any segment, no matter where, and no matter how small, would, when blown up by the computer microscope, reveal new molecules, each resembling the main set and yet not quite the same. Every new molecule would be surrounded by its own spirals and flame-like projections, and those, inevitably, would reveal molecules tinier still, always similar, never identical, fulfilling some mandate of infinite variety, a miracle of miniaturization in which every new detail was sure to be a universe of its own, diverse and entire. By the 1980s, a home computer could handle arithmetic precise enough to make colorful pictures of the set. The people who looked at such pictures saw that all the scales had similar patterns, yet every scale was different. And all these microscopic landscapes were generated by the same few lines of computer code. The boundary is when 100 or 1000 or 10,000 iterations fail to break away, a program still cannot be absolutely certain that a point falls inside the step. The boundary is where points are slowest to escape the pull of the set. It is as if they are balanced between competing attractors, one at zero and the other, in effect, ringing the set at a distance of infinity. The boundary between two or more attractors in a dynamical system served as a threshold of a kind that seems to govern so many ordinary processes, from the breaking of materials to the making of decisions. Each attractor in such a system has its basin, as a river has a watershed basin that drains into it. Each basin has a boundary. The study of fractal basin boundaries was the study of systems that could reach one of several non-chaotic final states. York proposed an imaginary pinball machine. Like most pinball machines, it has a plunger with a spring. You pull back the plunger and release it to send the ball up into the playing area. The machine has the customary tilted landscape of rubber edges and electric bouncers that give the ball a kick of extra energy. The kick is important, it means that energy does not just decay smoothly. For simplicity's sake, this machine has no flippers at the bottom, just two exit ramps. The ball must leave by one ramp or the other. This is deterministic pinball, no shaking the machine. Only one parameter controls the ball's destination, and that is the initial position of the plunger. The boundary proves to be a fractal set, not necessarily self-similar, but infinitely detailed. Some regions of the line will be pure red or green, while others, when magnified, will show new regions of red within the green, or green within the red. For some plunger positions, that is, a tiny change makes no difference. But for others, even an arbitrarily small change will make the difference between red and green. York would rise at conferences to display pictures of fractal basin boundaries. To make such pictures, his computer had swept through a 1000 by 1000 grid of points, each representing a different starting position for the pendulum, and had plotted the outcome, black or white. These were basins of attraction, mixed and folded by the familiar equations of Newtonian motion, and the result was more boundary than anything else. Typically, more than 3/4 of the plotted points lay on the boundary. Scientists studying fractal basin boundaries showed that the border between calm and catastrophe could be far more complex than anyone had dreamed. Fractal basin boundaries address deep issues in theoretical physics. Phase transitions were matters of thresholds. Peitkin and Richter looked at magnetization and non-magnetization in materials. Their pictures of such boundaries displayed the peculiarly beautiful complexity that was coming to seem so natural, cauliflower shapes with progressively more tangled knobs and furrows. As they varied the parameters and increased their magnification of details, one picture seemed more and more random, until suddenly, unexpectedly, deep in the heart of a bewildering region, appeared a familiar oblate form, studded with buds, the Mandelbrot set, every tendril and every atom in place. It was another signpost of universality. Barnsley thought about nature's own images, particularly the patterns generated by living organisms. Finally, he turned to randomness as the basis for a new technique of modeling natural shapes. The chaos game. You choose a starting point somewhere on the paper. You invent two rules, a heads rule and a tails rule. A rule tells you how to take one point to another, move 2 inches to the northeast, or move 25% closer to the center. Now you start flipping the coin and marking points, using the heads rule when the coin comes up heads and the tails rule when it comes up tails. If you throw away the first 50 points, you will find the chaos game producing not a random field of dots but a shape, revealed with greater and greater sharpness as the game goes on. As time goes on, the result begins to approach the area of the shapes as the limit of a random process. In dynamical terms, Barnsley's shapes proved to be attractors. By using the chaos game instead, Barnsley made pictures that began as fuzzy parodies and grew progressively sharper. No refinement process was necessary, just a single set of rules that somehow embodied the final shape. The key question was how to reverse the process, given a particular shape, how to choose a set of rules. The answer, which he called collage theorem, you would begin with a drawing of the shape you wanted to reproduce. Barnsley chose a black spleenwort fern for one of his first experiments, having long been a fern buff. Then using a computer terminal and a mouse as pointing device, you would lay small copies over the original shape, letting them overlap sloppily if need be. A highly fractal shape could easily be tiled with copies of itself, a less fractal shape less easily, and at some level of approximation every shape could be tiled. Hubbard. I strongly suspect that the day somebody actually figures out how the brain is organized, they will discover to their amazement that there is a coding scheme for building the brain which is of extraordinary precision. The idea of randomness in biology is just reflex. In Barnsley's technique, however, chance serves only as a tool. The results are deterministic and predictable. The Mandelbrot set, in the same way, exists. It existed before Peitkin and Richter began turning it into an art form, before Hubbard and Doughty understood its mathematical essence, even before Mandelbrot discovered it. It existed as soon as science created a context, a framework of complex numbers and a notion of iterated functions. Then it waited to be unveiled. Or perhaps it existed even earlier, as soon as nature began organizing itself by means of simple physical laws, repeated with infinite patience and everywhere the same. The dynamical systems collective. William Burke, he spent several nights in that basement, watching the green dot of the oscilloscope flying around the screen, tracing over and over the characteristic owl's mask of the Lorentz attractor. He quickly saw the sensitive dependence on initial conditions that persuaded Edward Lorentz of the futility of long-term weather forecasting. He would set the initial conditions, push the go button, and off the attractor would go. Then he would set the same initial conditions again as close as physically possible and the orbit would sail merrily away from its previous course, yet end up on the same attractor. The notion that you could have determinism but not really, Farmer said. The idea that all these classical deterministic systems we'd learned about could generate randomness was intriguing. We were driven to understand what made that tick. We had no concept of the real difference that nonlinearity makes in a model. The idea that an equation could bounce around in an apparently random way. On a philosophical level, it struck me as an operational way to define free will, in a way that allowed you to reconcile free will with determinism. The system is deterministic, but you can't say what it's going to do next. At the same time, I'd always felt that the important problems out there in the world had to do with the creation of organization, in life, or intelligence. Here was one coin with two sides. Here was order, with randomness emerging, and then one step further away was randomness with its own underlying order. Joseph Ford. Where were the calipers to gauge such a quality? Could unpredictability itself be measured? The Lyapunov exponent. This number provided a measure of just the topological qualities that corresponded to such concepts as unpredictability. The Lyapunov exponents in a system provided a way of measuring the conflicting effects of stretching, contracting, and folding in the phase space of an attractor. They gave a picture of all the properties of a system that lead to stability or instability. An exponent greater than zero meant stretching nearby points would separate. An exponent smaller than zero meant contraction. For a fixed-point attractor, all the Lyapunov exponents were negative, since the direction of pull was inward toward the final steady state. An attractor in the form of a periodic orbit had one exponent of exactly zero and other exponents that were negative. A strange attractor, it turned out, had to have at least one positive Lyapunov exponent. They used computer animation to make movies illustrating the beating together of order and chaos in dynamical systems. Their analysis showed vividly how some systems could create disorder in one direction while remaining trim and methodical in another. One movie showed what happened to a tiny cluster of nearby points representing initial conditions on a strange attractor as the system evolved in time. The cluster began to spread out and lose focus. It turned into a dot and then a blob. For certain kinds of attractors, the blob would quickly spread all over. Such attractors were efficient at mixing. For other attractors, though, the spreading would only occur in certain directions. The blob would become a band, chaotic along one axis and orderly along another. It was as if the system had an orderly impulse and a disorderly one together, and they were decoupling. As one impulse led to random unpredictability, the other kept time like a precise clock. Both impulses could be defined and measured. Claude Shannon, the mathematical theory of communication. Information theory, ordinary language contains greater than 50% redundancy in the form of sounds or letters that are not strictly necessary to conveying a message. This is a familiar idea. Ordinary communication in a world of mumbles and typographical errors depends on redundancy. And information theory allowed it to be measured. Redundancy is a predictable departure from the random. Part of the redundancy in ordinary language lies in its meaning, and that part is hard to quantify, depending as it does on people's shared knowledge of their language and the world. To Shannon, the right way to look at such patterns was this: a stream of data in ordinary language is less than random, each new bit is partly constrained by the bits before, thus, each new bit carries somewhat less than a bit's worth of real information. There was a hint of paradox floating in this formulation. The more random a data stream, the more information would be conveyed by each new bit. Beyond Shannon's field could be attributed to the choice of a single word, entropy. The concept of entropy comes from thermodynamics, where it serves as an adjunct of the second law, the inexorable tendency of the universe, and any isolated system in it, to slide toward a state of increasing disorder. Divide a swimming pool in half with some barrier, fill one half with water and one with ink, wait for all to be still, lift the barrier, simply through the random motion of molecules, eventually the ink and water will mix. The mixing never reverses itself, even if you wait till the end of the universe, which is why the second law is so often said to be the part of physics that makes time a one-way street. And what about the topologically perverse patterns of a strange attractor? To Robert Shaw, strange attractors were engines of information. In his first and grandest conception, chaos offered a natural way of returning to the physical sciences, in reinvigorated form, the ideas that information theory had drawn from thermodynamics. Strange attractors, conflating order and disorder, gave a challenging twist to the question of measuring a system's entropy. Strange attractors served as efficient mixers. They created unpredictability. They raised entropy. And as Shaw saw it, they created information where none existed. Lewis Jacket Competition. He finally mailed his paper to the Jacket Competition. The paper, a blend of esoteric mathematics and speculative philosophy, illustrated with cartoon-like drawings by Shaw's brother Chris, won an honorable mention. Shaw received a large enough cash prize. Strange attractors, chaotic behavior, and information flow. Shaw brought some assumptions of classical mechanics out of the shadows. Energy in natural systems exists on two levels, the macroscales, where everyday objects can be counted and measured, and the microscales, where countless atoms swim in random motion, unmeasurable except as an average entity, temperature. The total energy living in the microscales could outweigh the energy of the macroscales, but in classical systems this thermal motion was irrelevant, isolated and unusable. The scales do not communicate with one another. However, that chaotic and near-chaotic systems bridged the gap between macroscales and microscales. Chaos was the creation of information. As the system becomes chaotic, however, strictly by virtue of its unpredictability, it generates a steady stream of information. Each new observation is a new bit. He could never leave the room, as Shaw said. The flow would be a continuous source of information. Where is this information coming from? The heat bath of the microscales, billions of molecules in their random thermodynamic dance. So information is transmitted back from the small scales to the large at any rate. This was how Shaw and his colleagues began describing it. And the channel transmitting the information upward is the strange attractor, magnifying the initial randomness just as the butterfly effect magnifies small uncertainties into large-scale weather patterns. The question was how much entropy per unit time. The technique was a matter of drawing some arbitrarily small box around some set of initial conditions, then calculating the effect of various expansions or twists on the box. It might stretch in one direction, for example, while remaining narrow in the other. The change in area corresponded to an introduction of uncertainty about the system's past, a gain, or loss of information. The problem of adding extrinsic noise to an otherwise deterministic system, for example, was new in dynamics but familiar enough in communications. When they spoke of systems generating information, they thought about the spontaneous generation of pattern in the world. At the pinnacle of complicated dynamics are processes of biological evolution, or thought processes, Packard said. Intuitively, there seems a clear sense in which these ultimately complicated systems are generating information. Billions of years ago, there were just blobs of protoplasm, now, billions of years later, here we are. So, information has been created and stored in our structure. In the development of one person's mind from childhood, information is clearly not just accumulated but also generated, created from connections that were not there before. They were tinkerers first. A physicist trying to model the drip problem completely in the dripping faucet, the single line of data is all there is. And it isn't even a continuously varying velocity or temperature, just a list of drip times. An alternative approach would be to forget about the physics and look only at the data, as though it were coming out of a black box. Given a list of numbers representing intervals between drips, could an expert in chaotic dynamics find something useful to say? Indeed, as it turned out, methods could be devised for organizing such data and working backward into the physics, and these methods became critical to the applicability of chaos to real-world problems. But Shaw began halfway between these extremes. The only interesting feature, and the nonlinear twist that made chaotic behavior possible, was that the next drip depended on how the springiness interacted with the steadily increasing weight. Shaw's model was exactly crude enough to be summed up in three differential equations, the minimum necessary for chaos. But would it generate as much complexity as a real faucet? And would the complexity be of the same kind? Shaw tried a technique. It was a method of reconstructing a phase space for an unseen strange attractor, and it could be applied to any series of data at all. For the dripping faucet data, Shaw made a two-dimensional graph in which the x-axis represented a time interval between a pair of drops and the y-axis represented the next time interval. If 150 milliseconds passed between drop 1 and drop 2, and then 150 milliseconds passed between drop 2 and drop 3, he would plot a point at the position 150 to 150. If the dripping was regular, as it tended to be when the water flowed slowly and the system was in its water clock regime, the graph would be suitably dull. Every point would land at the same place. The graph would be a single dot. Or almost. Actually, the first difference between the computer dripping faucet and the real dripping faucet was that the real version was subject to noise, and exceedingly sensitive. Noise meant that, instead of the single dot predicted by theory, he would see a slightly fuzzy blob. The real test came when the pattern became chaotic. If it were truly random, points would be scattered all over the graph. There would be no relation to be found between one interval and the next. But if a strange attractor were hidden in the data, it might reveal itself as a coalescence of fuzziness into distinguishable structures. Often three dimensions were necessary to see the structure. Ordinarily, a three-dimensional graph required knowledge of three independent variables in a system. The trick gave three variables for the price of one. In the case of Shaw's dripping faucet, the pictures illustrated the point. In three dimensions, especially, the patterns emerged. Shaw was able to match plots of the experimental data with data produced by his analog computer model, the main difference being that the real data was always fuzzier, smeared out by noise. Even so, the structure was unmistakable. They learned how to retrieve strange attractors from all kinds of systems. It was a matter of embedding the data in a phase space of enough dimensions. Soon discovered, the technique distinguishes between mere noise and chaos, in the new sense, orderly disorder created by simple processes. Truly random data remains spread out in an undefined mess. But chaos, deterministic and patterned, pulls the data into visible shapes. Of all the possible pathways of disorder, nature favors just a few. Farmer said. The idea of universality was not just a great result. Mitchell's thing was also a technique to employ a whole army of unemployed critical phenomena people. Up to that point, it appeared that nonlinear systems would have to be treated in a case-by-case way. We were trying to come up with a language to quantify it and describe it. Universality meant finding properties that were exactly the same in quantifiable ways for everything in that class. Predictable properties. That's why it was really important. And there was a sociological factor that pumped even more fuel. Mitchell cast his results in the language of renormalization. Laguna Beach in 1978. Shaw began by explaining attractors in phase space, first fixed points, where everything stops, then limit cycles, where everything oscillates, then strange attractors, everything else. He demonstrated with his computer graphics on videotape. Audiovisual aids gave us an edge, he said. We could hypnotize them with flashing lights. He illuminated the Lorentz attractor and the dripping faucet. He explained the geometry, how shapes are stretched and folded, and what that meant in the grand terms of information theory. And for good measure, he put in a few words at the end about shifting paradigms. The talk was a popular triumph, and in the audience were several members of the Santa Cruz faculty, seeing chaos for the first time through the eyes of their colleagues. In 1979, the whole group attended the second chaos meeting. An attractor's dimension was the first level of knowledge necessary to characterize its properties. It was the feature that gave the amount of information necessary to specify the position of a point on the attractor to within a given accuracy. They tied these ideas to the rate of decay of predictability, the rate of information flow, the tendency to create mixing. Sometimes scientists using these methods would find themselves plotting data, drawing little boxes, and counting the number of data points in each box. Yet even such seemingly crude techniques brought chaotic systems for the first time within the reach of scientific understanding. Meanwhile, having learned to look for strange attractors in flapping flags and rattling speedometers, the scientists made a point of finding the symptoms of deterministic chaos all through the current literature of physics. Unexplained noise, surprising fluctuations, regularity mixing with irregularity, these effects popped up in papers from experimentalists working with everything from particle accelerators to lasers to Josephson junctions. The chaos specialists would make these symptoms their own, telling the unconverted, in effect, your problems are our problems. Several experiments on Josephson junction oscillators have revealed a striking noise rise phenomena, a paper would begin, which cannot be accounted for in terms of thermal fluctuations. All the others went on different journeys, only Shaw seemed reluctant to join the mainstream. His own influential legacy comprised just two papers, one that had won him a trip to Paris and one, about the dripping faucet. Several times, he came close to quitting science altogether. As one of his friends said, he was oscillating. Inner rhythms. 1986. The first major conference on chaos in biology and medicine. Scientists have known of a physical manifestation of the disease that seems to afflict not only schizophrenics but also their relatives. When patients try to watch a slowly swinging pendulum, their eyes cannot track the smooth motion. A healthy person's eyes stay locked on moving targets without the least conscious thought, moving images stay frozen in place on the retina. But a schizophrenic's eyes jump about disruptively in small increments, overshooting or undershooting the target and creating a constant haze of extraneous movements. Huberman thought in the crudest possible way about the mechanics of the eye and wrote down an equation. There was a term for the amplitude of the swinging pendulum and a term for its frequency. There was a term for the eye's inertia. There was a term for damping, or friction. And there were terms for error correction, to give the eye a way of locking in on the target. The resulting equation happens to describe an analogous mechanical system, a ball rolling in a curved trough while the trough swings from side to side. The side-to-side motion corresponds to the motion of the pendulum, and the walls of the trough correspond to the error-correcting feature, tending to push the ball back toward the center. He found both order and chaos. In some regimes, the eye would track smoothly, then, as the degree of nonlinearity was increased, the system would go through a fast period doubling sequence and produce a kind of disorder that was indistinguishable. Huberman's model seemed to match a plausible genetic model for schizophrenia. A nonlinearity that could either stabilize the system or disrupt it, depending on whether the nonlinearity was weak or strong, might correspond to a single genetic trait. One psychiatrist compared the concept to the genetics of gout, in which too high a level of uric acid creates pathological symptoms. Others pointed out that schizophrenics were not alone. A whole range of eye movement problems could be found in different kinds of neurological patients. Periodic oscillations, aperiodic oscillations, all sorts of dynamical behavior. What's actually the case is that, as physicians or scientists learning all 50,000 parts of everything, we resent the possibility that there are in fact universal elements of motion. In the 1980s, chaos brought to life a new kind of physiology, built on the idea that mathematical tools could help scientists understand global complex systems independent of local detail. Researchers increasingly recognized the body as a place of motion and oscillation. They found rhythms that were invisible on frozen microscope slides or daily blood samples. They studied chaos in respiratory disorders. They explored feedback mechanisms in the control of red and white blood cells. Cancer specialists speculated about periodicity and irregularity in the cycle of cell growth. Psychiatrists explored a multidimensional approach to the prescription of antidepressant drugs. The heart, whose animated rhythms, stable or unstable, healthy or pathological, so precisely measured the difference between life and death. David Ruel, chaos in the heart. The normal cardiac regime is periodic, but there are many non-periodic pathologies, like ventricular fibrillation, which lead to the steady state of death. It seems that great medical benefit might be derived from computer studies of a realistic mathematical model which would reproduce the various cardiac dynamical regimes. To the trained ear, dozens of irregular rhythms can be distinguished. To the trained eye, the spiky patterns of the electrocardiogram offer clues to the source and the seriousness of an irregular rhythm. Different sorts of arrhythmias. There are ectopic beats, electrical alternans, and torsades de points. There are high-grade block and escape rhythms. There is parasystole, atrial or ventricular, pure or modulated. There are Wenckebach rhythms, simple or complex. There is tachycardia. Most damaging of all to the prospect for survival is fibrillation. They discovered the dynamical heart. Typically, he said, specialists diagnose many different arrhythmias by looking at short strips of electrocardiograms. It's treated by physicians as a pattern recognition problem, a matter of identifying patterns they have seen before in practice and in textbooks. They really don't analyze in detail the dynamics of these rhythms. The dynamics are much richer than anybody would guess from reading the textbooks. In 1986 you won't find the word fractals in a physiology book, he said. I think in 1996 you won't be able to find a physiology book without it. A doctor listening to the heartbeat hears the whooshing and pounding of fluid against solid, and solid against solid. Blood courses from chamber to chamber, squeezed by the contracting muscles behind, and then stretches the walls ahead. Fibrous valves snap shut audibly against the backflow. The muscle contractions themselves depend on a complex three-dimensional wave of electrical activity. Trial and error, for example, has governed the design of artificial heart valves, the metal and plastic devices heart valve, a filmy, pliant, translucent arrangement of three tiny parachute-like cups. To let blood into the heart's pumping chambers, the valve must fold gracefully out of the way. To keep blood from backing up when the heart pumps it forward, the valve must fill and slam closed under the pressure, and it must do so, without leaking or tearing, 2 or 3 billion times. Human engineers have not done so well. By changing the patterns of fluid flow in the heart, artificial valves create areas of turbulence and areas of stagnation. When blood stagnates, it forms clots. When clots break off and travel to the brain, they cause strokes. In the mid-1980s, their computer made motion pictures of a beating heart, two-dimensional but vividly recognizable. Hundreds of dots, representing particles of blood, stream through the valve, stretching the elastic walls of the heart and creating whirling vortices. The mathematicians found that the heart adds a whole level of complexity to the standard fluid flow problem, because any realistic model must take into account the elasticity of the heart walls themselves. Instead of flowing over a rigid surface, like air over an airplane wing, blood changes the heart surface dynamically and nonlinearly. A classic metaphor for the fibrillating heart, a bag of worms. Instead of contracting and relaxing in a repetitive, periodic way, the heart's muscle tissue writhes, uncoordinated, helpless to pump blood. In a normally beating heart, the electrical signal travels as a coordinated wave through the three-dimensional structure of the heart. When the signal arrives, each cell contracts. Then each cell relaxes for a critical refractory period, during which it cannot be set off again prematurely. In a fibrillating heart, the wave breaks up. The heart is never all contracted or all relaxed. Fibrillation is a disorder of a complex system, just as mental disorders, whether or not they have chemical roots, are disorders of a complex system. The heart will not stop fibrillating on its own. This brand of chaos is stable. Only a jolt of electricity from a defibrillation device, a jolt that any dynamicist recognizes as a massive perturbation, can return the heart to its steady state. Defibrillators are effective. But their design, like the design of artificial heart valves, has required much guesswork. Four other abnormal heart rhythms and assortment of drug therapies have been tried, also based largely on trial and error without a sound theoretical understanding of the heart's dynamics. It is tricky to predict the effects of a given drug. Winfrey's view: the problem of circadian rhythms should lend itself to a mathematical style of thinking. I had a headful of nonlinear dynamics and realized that the problem could be thought of, and ought to be thought of, in terms of complex systems theory and nonlinear and topological dynamics. Mosquitoes: every 23 hours, they buzz around with particular intensity. What keeps them on track outdoors is the jolt of light they get each day. In effect, it resets their clock. He came to a startling conclusion: there was a singularity in the geometry, a point different from all the other points. Looking at the singularity, he predicted that one special, precisely timed burst of light would cause a complete breakdown of a mosquito's biological clock, or any other biological clock. You've given him perpetual jet lag. Experiment: time isolation. No daylight, no temperature change, no clocks, and no telephones. People have a sleep-wake cycle and also a body temperature cycle, both nonlinear oscillators that restore themselves after slight perturbations. In isolation, without a daily resetting stimulus, the temperature cycle seems to be about 25 hours, with the low occurring during sleep. But after some weeks, the sleep-wake cycle would detach itself from the temperature cycle and become erratic. People would stay awake for 20 or 30 hours at a time, followed by 10 or 20 hours of sleep. Not only would the subjects remain unaware that their day had lengthened, they would refuse to believe it when told. In the mid-1980s, apply Winfrey's systematic approach to humans: an elderly woman who did needlepoint in the evening in front of banks of bright light. Her cycle changed sharply, and she reported feeling great. As for Winfrey, he had moved on to the subject of rhythms in the heart. After he helplessly witnessed the sudden cardiac deaths of two people, one a relative on a summer vacation, the other a man in a pool where Winfrey was swimming. But one difference between hearts and biological clocks, a difference that cannot be set aside even in a simplified model, is that a heart has a shape in space. You can hold it in your hand. You can track an electrical wave through three dimensions. Eicher's technique, depending heavily on real-time computer processing, was to embed 128 electrodes in a web that he would place over a heart like a sock on a foot. The electrodes recorded the voltage field as each wave traveled through the muscle, and the computer produced a cardiac map. Eicher began to assemble the physical understanding necessary to make the design of defibrillators less a high-priced guessing game, more a science. Why should the laws of chaos apply to the heart, with its peculiar tissue cells forming interconnected branching fibers, transporting ions of calcium, potassium, and sodium? Ectopic beat school and the reentry school. By stressing the methods of nonlinear dynamics, both groups of researchers were able to use the awareness that a small change in one parameter, perhaps a change in timing or electrical conductivity, could push an otherwise healthy system across a bifurcation point into a qualitatively new behavior. They also began to find common ground for studying heart problems globally, linking disorders that were previously considered unrelated. Winfrey suggested that the two ideas might be one and the same. Dynamical things are generally counterintuitive, and the heart is no exception. Now, some physiologists speak of dynamical diseases, disorders of systems, breakdowns in coordination or control. But physiologists have also begun to see chaos as health. Simply put, a linear process, given a slight nudge, tends to remain slightly off track. A nonlinear process, given the same nudge, tends to return to its starting point. Christian Huygens noticed one day that a set of pendulum clocks placed against a wall happened to be swinging in perfect chorus line synchronization. He surmised, correctly, that the clocks were coordinated by vibrations transmitted through the wood. This phenomenon, in which one regular cycle locks into another, is now called entrainment, or mode locking. Mode locking explains why the moon always faces the Earth, or more generally why satellites tend to spin in some whole number ratio of their orbital period, 1 to 1, or 2 to 1, or 3:2. When the ratio is close to a whole number, nonlinearity in the tidal attraction of the satellite tends to lock it in. Mode locking occurs throughout electronics, making it possible, for example, for a radio receiver to lock in on signals even when there are small fluctuations in their frequency. Mode locking accounts for the ability of groups of oscillators, including biological oscillators, like heart cells and nerve cells, to work in synchronization. But, in biological systems is flexibility, how well can a system function over a range of frequencies? Ari Goldberger proposed that healthy dynamics were marked by fractal physical structures, like the branching networks of bronchial tubes in the lung and conducting fibers in the heart, that allow a wide range of rhythms. Fractal processes associated with scaled, broadband spectra are information-rich. Periodic states, in contrast, reflect narrowband spectra and are defined by monotonous, repetitive sequences, depleted of information content suggested, may depend on broadening a system's spectral reserve, its ability to range over many different frequencies without falling into a locked periodic channel. Arnold Mandel: is it possible that mathematical pathology, i.e. chaos, is health? And that mathematical health, which is the predictability and differentiability of this kind of a structure, is disease. He found peculiar behavior in certain enzymes in the brain that could only be accounted for by the new methods of nonlinear mathematics. He had encouraged the study of the oscillating three-dimensional entanglements of protein molecules in the same terms. Instead of drawing static structures, he argued, biologists should understand such molecules as dynamical systems, capable of phase transitions. Psychopharmacology: the use of drugs to treat everything from anxiety and insomnia to schizophrenia itself has to be judged a failure. Few patients, if any, are cured. The most violent manifestations of mental illness can be controlled, but with what long-term consequences, no one knows. Phenothiazines, prescribed for schizophrenics, make the fundamental disorder worse. Tricyclic antidepressants increase the rate of mood cycling, leading to long-term increases in numbers of relapsing psychopathologic episodes. And so on. Only lithium has any real medical success, and only for some disorders. With or without chaos, serious cognitive scientists can no longer model the mind as a static structure. They recognize a hierarchy of scales, from neuron upward, providing an opportunity for the interplay of microscale and macroscale so characteristic of fluid turbulence and other complex dynamical processes. Chaos and beyond. They believed that simple, deterministic systems could breed complexity, that systems too complex for traditional mathematics could yet obey simple laws, and that, whatever their particular field, their task was to understand complexity itself. I never put the last chapter of the book, I only put the best paragraph I found, because if the book is good, the last chapter contains all the info in it, so I can't really highlight the parts, because I could straight copy-paste the whole chapter. If you want to know the end, and all the context in the book, you should buy the book. Tidy.